Our first game on Radio Bob. How do you feel it's going so far?
Well, we had kind of a rough start, but I think we've picked it up since then.
That could be said about our media careers too, couldn't it?
Yeah,
it's
folks.
Brought us fame and fortune, though.
Folks, if you've never listened to a game that we've broadcast before, I'd love to tell you you're really in for a treat, but you know, not so much.
Yeah. It's really, really something,
is what it is. Yep, that's the best we can say.
So very little breeze tonight, like I mentioned before. Been raining for at least an hour now, and it's coming straight down. Nobody's going to have a wind advantage the way things are looking right now, and everybody's going to be dealing with slippery conditions.
And frankly, it's going to keep the ball on the ground tonight, and with these two teams, that makes no difference at all. These two teams are both ground-first-oriented teams, DeForest especially. Mitch Kelsey, the new quarterback for Monona Grove, had a rough week last week, 2 for 9 for 27 yards. Obviously, I'm sure he had first-game jitters. Thankfully, Torin Young and Andre Neherniak were able to pick up the slack for him, and Monona Grove's bend don't break defense was able to get just enough stops to get the victory last week. A good win against a very good football team, a team that will likely contend for the Badger North title this year.
All right, DeForest teeing it up, ready to kick off. Back deep for the Silver Eagles is Andre Neherniak, flanked by Brady Blang, and I think that's Tyler Patton. I can't quite make out his jersey.
I don't know who picked out the new uniforms for the Silver Eagles this year, but hey, you know what? You could have made brighter, bigger numbers for us
old
guys.
Kick. Is that number 4?
Kind of hard to say from here. Yep, that was number 4.
Kyle Kapouch. My apologies if we butchered that at
all. Yeah. Call in or post something. If we pronounced a kid's name wrong, let us know, because we really do want to pronounce the names right. We're terrible homers, and we want to make heroes out of all these kids.
All right, Mitch Kelsey at quarterback for the Silver Eagles. Single setback is, of course, Torin Young. Wingbacks are 21. Andre Neherniak split out to the far side. I can't see. I think that's Brady Blang. And the give to, no, Kelsey on the keeper.
He's
out. Running room,
and
Kelsey.
Go.
Across the 50, 40, 30. It's a foot race now. Kelsey to the house.
Touchdown.
First play of the game, Mitch Kelsey.
So
72?
73 yards, Steve. The fake to Torin Young and around N, and boy, DeForest was very slow to pick up on that. And in fact, I believe, this is another thing in the first game, folks, we're going to stumble over numbers for a while. Number 31, Shea Sims for DeForest had the angle on Kelsey, but Kelsey just beat him down the sideline. Nice speed by Mitch Kelsey. And that's the way to start off our 20th season, Steve.
All right.
First play touchdown run.
Number 19, Colin Larsh, ready to kick the extra point. Larsh, I understand, is a transfer in, Bob. Here's his extra point.
Looks
and he
good.
Kicks it through.
The extra point is up.
Yep, 3 for 4 last week in extra points, 1 for 1 tonight. And that's a nice start for Monona Grove.
Well, 16 seconds in, Mitchell Kelsey. Having some positive impact on the offense.
Yes, indeed. Not with his arm so much so far, but certainly his legs. Good for Mitch. And that's got to be very exciting for him, his first varsity touchdown.
Now the Silver Eagles with 3 touchdowns already this season of 70 yards or more, Bob. That's that's big play potential that some seasons we don't see any of them that long.
That is absolutely right.
Already we've got 3 of them. Kelsey showing some nice speed. I had mentioned his athleticism, but I didn't recognize he had the breakaway speed that he does.
Yeah, I thought he'd get hauled down about the 10 or 15 yard line because Sims had that nice angle on him, but Kelsey just outraced him down the sideline. Sims forced to just make a diving attempt and came up empty.
All right. Back deep for DeForest, number 30, Abraham Schradl.
Abraham.
Yes.
It's from Holiday Inn.
Is it?
Yeah.
I'm more of a country Inn and sweets guy.
Dude, people that have seen Holiday Inn know exactly what I'm doing.
Boomer Larsh ready to kick this one off for the Silver Eagles. Straight down the middle, and Grail will take it about the 5-yard line. Up across the 20, 25, and brought down just over the 25-yard line, where it'll be 1st and 10 for the Norskies.
Let's see who's on the bottom of the pile there.
7-0, a Silver Eagle lead.
Looked like number 22, Chase Hatton, and number 15, Frankie Langer on the tackle there.
The players to watch on the DeForest side, number two, their quarterback, Connor True, and number 25 at Jaden Sackman.
Jaden Sackman, we've talked about him a little bit. His running mate, Tyler Blom, had a pretty good year last year, number 33.
All right, two wideouts to this side, one to the far side. Sackman, the lone tailback. No, they're out of a shotgun. That's True back there by himself. Looking to throw on first down. Lofting one to Sackman.
Nice
tipped
play.
And batted
Patton.
Away by number Patton. Six, Tyler Patton.
Tyler Patton. Tyler Patton came up with 12 tackles last week too, Steve, from his defensive back position. Nice job of anticipating the throw and getting up to make the block.
I believe Patton also recovered a fumble in the end zone.
He did indeed.
Good defensive effort on that one. It's second and 10 now for the Norskies. The ball at the 27-yard line of DeForest.
Kind of an unusual, obviously they saw a lot on film of what Monona couldn't do against the pass last week and wanted to try it out. I don't think we're going to see that on this play, especially coming from the I formation.
The I formation, Sackman is the full or the running back. They give us to Sackman. Sackman, left side, has a couple yards, gets across the 30 and brought down after about a five-yard pickup.
Dahlhauser in on the tackle, and also number 77, that would be Keontae Ferge. Keontae played a little bit last year as a junior, getting a chance to start this year as a senior.
Third and four for the Norskies now. 7-0, MG leads, 1 minute underway.
Don't be surprised to see Sackman get it here on third and four.
Out of the shotgun, he's next to quarterback True. It's True. True rolling out. Looking for Sackman, looking beyond Sackman.
No,
nope.
Hit the ground. That's
off the hands of number 87, that's Dryden Van Schoik.
That is an awesome name.
Dryden Van Schoik.
That is right out of a 1940s film noir movie.
Say.
Who's this Dryden Van Schoik?
Who's this Van Schoik guy knows it about?
That is an awesome name.
All right, that brings up fourth down and forces the Norskies to punt. Naherniak and Blang will drop back for the Silver Eagles. Both of them did some punt returning last year. Both of them have some nice speed. I'd like to see the Silver Eagles get a decent return out of this one and get some good field position.
Yeah, I'm surprised to see them come out passing. I mean, I know Monona had a bad week pass defense-wise last week, but still.
Nice kick. Brady Blang will drop back and take this. No, he's going to let it roll, and it's going to be downed at the 25-yard line of the Silver Eagles.
I actually thought Andrew Naherniak was going to take that, but it went over his head.
Yeah,
he might have misjudged that a little bit.
He came up, and Blang went behind him. I thought it was going to sail to Blang, but they let it drop. So the 26-yard line, first and 10 for the Silver Eagles.
So anyway, as I was saying, Connor True last week went 7 for 12. Not bad. Only 63 yards, though. Last year, True only threw for like 48% completion rate. So I don't know.
Silver Eagles with two wideouts to the far side, one to the near side. I formation with Torin Young as the tailback. Young gets the handoff this time. Gets a yard or two maybe and then pushed back.
Yeah, wrapped up by number 8, Jackson Hemauer. Yeah, 6-foot linebacker.
They're going to key on Theron, Torin Young all season. So,
when are you going to bust out his nickname, Steve?
The Tornado?
Yeah, right now, I guess, huh?
Yeah. Wheatley starts running. I've got a touchdown call ready for him. All right, Mitchell Kelsey bringing in the signals or the play.
That would make a pretty cool shirt, though. You know, the Tornado.
The Tornado,
that
yeah.
That would make a pretty neat T-shirt.
A big whirlwind with a 28 in it.
Yeah, I like it.
Football's sailing about.
Yeah, somewhere with an MG on there.
Kelsey calling the signals. The handoff to Young again. Young cutting it back against the grain. Spinning and getting dropped short of the 30. That's going to bring up third and long for the Silver Eagles.
Nice work by the interior defensive line by DeForest. They just haven't given an inch on the inside of the line there.
And that was Mount Horeb Barneveld's weakness last week is stopping him. He got a lot of runs into the defensive backfield. And he's just too strong for a defensive back to bring down one-on-one.
Oh, that's for sure. And like we talked about in the pregame, Steve, his speed seems to have really increased this year. So a lot of defensive backs might not be able to catch him either.
Double wing, double wideout. Kelsey out of the shotgun with Young behind him. Kelsey looking to run.
Quarterback draw.
Takes off on the draw. Across the 35, little spin move.
Come on, Mitch.
And
yep,
out to the 40 yards, falling forward. First down for Mitch Kelsey. Mitchell Kelsey, a left-handed quarterback, making a good call there.
That's a nice call. Quarterback draw. Gives Mitch goes back. He can pick his hole. He had his receivers doing downfield routes, so he had a lot of room once he got past that front four.
Remember a quarterback a few years ago, Von Drasek, making a living off those quarterback draws. He was a big, strong kid like Mitchell Kelsey, too.
He was a big kid, though. He was about 6'3", and he probably went about 220.
Yeah, he was old. He ended up playing wide receiver for the Madison Mustangs for a couple years.
Oh, yeah, I remember that, yeah.
All right, Kelsey under center now. I formation. The give is to Young. Left side, little running room across the 45.
Oh,
still
nice.
On his feet and stumbles across the 50. That might be a first down. Yes, it is. 11-yard pickup for Torrin Young.
Nice little help there at the end of it by Brady Blank. Blank just gave him a little shove and got him the first down, 11-yard pickup. Brady Blank, we were talking about how he'd filled out a little this year enough to play linebacker, and he clearly has. He looks like he's spent some time in the weight room.
Oh, Naherniak, the only wide out to the near side here. Torrin Young, the tailback. I haven't picked up who the fullback is yet.
No, Blang's on the wing.
39 is the fullback. We'll have that spin move by Torrin Young. Gets to the line of scrimmage and fights for 2 yards. 39 for the Silver Eagles. The fullback, Jacob Zaber, 6 foot tall, 207 pounds. That's a lot of beef in your backfield.
Yeah, it is.
Two guys well over 200 pounds.
We're going to only give him about a yard pickup on that.
Yep, you're right. Down to the 48-yard line, second and nine. 7:55 to play in the first quarter. 7-0 Silver Eagles. If you tuned in a little late, you missed it. Mitchell Kelsey on the first play from scrimmage going 72 yards for the touchdown. Silver Eagles up to the line. Quarterback Kelsey under center.
Blang is spread wide to this side. Can't tell who's in the slot. I think it might be Naherniak.
Yes, it is. Kelsey tucking it in, going to run again. Turns it upfield, gets out of bounds after a short pickup. He might have got a yard on that. That's going to bring up third and seven.
A nice rush there by the defensive line of DeForest. Kelsey recognized it almost immediately, brought the ball down and two-handed it, which is a good idea. That is a wet football tonight.
All right, now Zaber, the fullback, will come out. I think they went with an extra receiver on third and seven. 13 coming into the game, Nathan Nigg. How do you pronounce it?
We're going to ask for help from the public.
I'd like to buy a vowel.
But we're going with Nug on this one until we hear different.
Young, the only running back behind quarterback Kelsey. Kelsey with the keeper.
Yeah, that
gets a few yards, but he's going to be short of the first down. Went to the right side, just running along the line of scrimmage until cutting it upfield, but not enough for the first.
I think Monona should be punting on this, fourth and three or fourth and four.
And here comes your punt unit led by Boomer Larsh.
Yeah, that little quarterback keeper, a little counter play there. I'm telling you, Tyler Blang wore that out in 2013 when he was leading the Silver Eagles to the state championship that year.
Third and seven, though, you really got to sell that one to get him to bite on the fake, first of all. I believe that's Abraham Schuttle back again. Nice kick by Larch.
Yeah, coffin corner. Let's see. Yeah,
oh, my goodness.
Nice.
That looks like it went out of the left corner.
Where's he going to mark that? Oh, my.
Inside.
That is as perfect a punt as you could hope for there. That
inside
is,
the one-yard line, Bob.
He's punting from the 43-yard line. That is a 42 7/8-yard punt.
The Cookie Man, Dave Kersner, reminding us that's why they call him Boomer. That was absolutely the best you can kick a football.
You cannot. I think the end of the football is actually in the end zone. The middle of the football could not be more than a foot outside.
So
no
margin of error here for the Norskies. Quarterback True has Sackman and a fullback behind him. I think that's 32, Jacob Marty. The handoff to Sackman. He's got a few yards across the five and actually out to the 9-yard line. Good effort by Sackman, getting him out of a deep hole.
Nice blocking, actually, at the point of attack. A good hole for Sackman. Sackman was into the linebacking zone before the linebackers had a chance to move. Nice, nice play.
77, the big hole. Keontae Furge on the tackle.
Second and one. Oh, they're saying second and three. Not quite the placement I had thought. Give it to Sackman again. Sackman
That's
across
better.
The 10, and there he's got the first down.
That's Mo Betta defense right Sackman there. Tyler Patton and Brady Blang on the tackle there. He just barely got that first down.
All right, let's stop him here, though. 6:06 to play in the first quarter, a 7-0 MG lead.
Now, Sackman will be carrying the ball early and often tonight, averaging well over 30 carries a year last year. Went for 46 in two different games. Went for 283 yards in a game last year.
Sackman, the tailback behind fullback Blum. He gets the pitch this time. Sackman across the 15. Struggling, getting pushed back now by the Silver Eagle defense after the short gain.
To the 16. He's dropped by a flock of Eagles.
Looked like Adam Scaife in on that tackle, number 52.
Silver Eagles with some nice size on their defensive line. Not anybody particularly tall, but some solidly built fellas. And, of course, they always have those fast linebackers flying around.
Yeah, they sure do.
David
Manns this year and Tanner Dahlhauser. Remember, Tanner Dahlhauser scored three defensive touchdowns last year.
Yeah, he had a good year. We didn't even know who he was coming into the game. Sackman again ran into a Silver Eagle short of the line of scrimmage, and a loss this time will make it third and long.
That looked like
right up the middle, and he got stuffed.
That was Nathan Noog, I think.
Good for him.
Is he out there, number 13?
Stopped by 39, Jacob.
Oh, no, sorry. Number 39, Jacob Zaber took it.
We mentioned earlier these numbers are a little hard to read. The road numbers are even tougher. So our apologies if we screw it up, because we will.
Steve and I aren't exactly young bucks either.
The eyes go first.
It's not getting easier.
The eyes go first? I don't know. I forget. All right, True out of the shotgun. I believe that's Sackman next to him. Nope. Short pass. Oh, in and out of the hands of number 40, Bo Gaston. And that'll bring up fourth down again. So two possessions for the Norskies and their second punt coming up now.
Yeah, Bo Gaston, that hit him in the mitts. Need to come up with that, but with that wet ball, you're going to see, I think, a little bit of that tonight.
Well,
anyway.
And then the way it squirted, it could have almost been intercepted.
Yeah.
That's dangerous to let it go past you when you don't catch the ball.
It was either Blang or Zaber that was coming up for the tackle, and it squirted on by them.
So Blang and Herniak will drop back for the punt. Dryden Van Schroik to punt it for the Norskies. Inside his own 10. It's an end-over-end kick that's going to land
way
out of bounds. Silver Eagles
market.
Are going to have good field position.
They should mark it about the 40, the DeForest 40 or 35. Let's see where they mark it. I mean, that went out of bounds well before the 50. Oh, my.
Oh, they're going to mark it at the 49? They missed that by about 10 yards.
Oh, that's an awful mark. Just awful. I mean, we're sitting right where that ball crossed the out of bounds
line. It almost hit us, and we're sitting at the 49.
Oh, my. Yeah. DeForest certainly got a break on that one.
Yeah.
That's
oh, well,
a pitiful spot.
The ball at the DeForest 49-yard line, 4:24 to play, a 7-0 Silver Eagle lead. Kelsey will bring him back out onto the field. One wide out to the far side, double wing. Torin Young, the only setback. Oh, fumble.
Yeah.
And Kelsey falls on the ball. And now DeForest says they came up with it, and they did.
Number 72, that is Hunter Topple, the 6'3", 300-pound senior.
Topple, an all-conference player last year.
The fumble recovery by number 72, Hunter Topple.
Topple was all-conference on both tackle and defensive interior line.
Indeed. They're also a returning senior this year DeForest is Connor Gerton. He was actually the Badger North Offensive Lineman of the Year last year. So they should be able to move the ball on the ground with those guys leading the way.
Well, great field position for the Norskies. The ball on the 50-yard line right in front of us here. True out of the shotgun. He's got Sackman next to him. Sackman should be a defensive end with a name like that. True looking to throw. Swings it out. Off the hands of number 26, Jacob Capstran. So, Bob, I don't understand why they're throwing the ball this much in this condition with not a passing team.
There is no doubt in my mind that they spent a lot of time watching film of last week. But like I said earlier, that was Max Myler that was lighting it up.
He's a little bit different than Connor True.
He is a D1 quarterback. He's going to be playing D1 ball somewhere next year. It might not be at an SEC school, but he is definitely going to be playing D1 somewhere. And Connor True might be playing basketball somewhere.
Second and 10 for Connor True and the Norskies. The handoff this time to Stackman. Stackman trying to get the corner, has it at the 50, inside and pushed out of bounds near the 45-yard line of Monona Grove.
Yeah, making a diving attempt for him in the backfield and trying to figure out who that was there. 17, David Manns. Came up empty and a gain of five for Sekman.
Call it six, Bob. They spot the ball at the 44-yard line of Monona Grove.
Yeah, you're right.
Best field position of this young game for the Norskies. 4:06 to play in the first quarter, a 7-0 MG lead still. DeForest getting a little momentum. True under center. And a timeout called by the Norskies.
Yeah, pretty good idea. Coach Mike Minnick did not like the looks of what the defense was doing to his called play, calls timeout, because this is actually a good place to call it, because this is a good place for a first down, keep this drive going. And if nothing else, you know, you get this first down, and if you have to punt, you change the whole field position of the game, because after that last punt by the Boomer, Larch, Monona Grove owned field position.
Absolutely. Well, last week against Mount Horeb, Bob, you mentioned that Monona Grove had pretty good success on defense on fourth down. What'd you say? Mount Horeb went for it seven times?
Yeah, seven times, made it once.
Wow. Let's see if they can come up big here on this third down, because this would be a key play. Like you said, if they can get a first here, it's going to give them a little momentum and a chance to tie this score, although it appears extra points are not one of the Norskies' strong suits.
No.
Regal defense back out onto the field.
One for three last week. All right, just waiting for DeForest to take the field again. The officials are over talking to Coach Minnick and telling him to move it along.
Still 4:06 left. Stay tuned for halftime. We're going to throw it back to the WVMO studios and talk about some of the shows that we've got on the new radio station.
Yeah, pretty exciting. I was kind of looking it over last night. There's a couple of shows I'd sit and listen to.
Yes. Stacking with the handoff, looking to throw. Gets the pass away. It's a wobbly one.
It was interference. Oh, darn it.
No, that was not interference. He had no chance of catching that
ball.
But they're going to call it anyways.
He pulled up to make the catch, and the interference penalty is going to go against number 23, I believe.
Miles Thomas.
Miles Thomas. And he did run into him out there. Pretty easy call, I thought. Sackman got laid out by Brady Blang as he let that ball go.
It was a terrible throw, and if Thomas had turned around, he had a chance to pick that one.
So the 15-yard penalty will give him the automatic first down.
Pass interference against the Silver Eagles. So they'll march this off, and that'll put DeForest deep into Monona Grove territory.
Yeah, fortunately, in high school football, pass interference isn't spot foul. It's a 15-yard penalty, so that'll mitigate a little of the damage there.
Yeah, that'll take it down to the 29-yard line.
Yeah, Sackman just threw up a duck there, and unfortunately, Miles had his back to the ball and didn't see it and ran into the receiver.
We were talking earlier about Darren Schwinn before the game, and remember he used to do that halfback option pretty well.
Yeah, he did.
They did ran that with success several times.
I'm surprised that Coach Minnick pulled that one out of his hat this early in the game.
Yeah, you kind of save that one until you need it usually. All right, True out of the shotgun again to his left is Stackman. Double wideouts to the far side, now man in motion. Stackman with the handoff into the line, blasting his way inside the 25-yard line.
Yeah, he's a hard runner.
He runs hard, yeah.
6 foot, 205 pounds. He
gets his knees up.
Powerfully built.
How many carries have we got for Sackman already?
That was his sixth carry, Steve.
And we still have 340 to play in the first quarter.
He's going to carry the ball a lot tonight.
All right, second and four for the Norskies. Second and four. The ball on the 23-yard line of Monona Grove. 3:30 to play in the first quarter. A 7-0 MG lead. True under center. I formation. He gives to Stackman up the middle. And Stackman stumbling and stopped short of the end zone. I thought he was in. If he keeps on his feet, he goes in to the 6-yard line now. And we've got a Silver Eagle down back near the 15-yard line.
Yeah, unfortunately, could not see who made that touchdown-saving arm tackle.
Yeah, they just tripped up Sackman. Otherwise, he was in the end zone.
Yeah, that might have been number three, Jarrett Meyer, made that tackle.
Well, we've got an injured Silver Eagle on the field. It's going to be first and goal for the Norskies. I'm going to pull this a little more shut.
Yeah, we're getting a little wind in here now. And it's not just us.
That's Jacob Zaber. Hopefully he's all right. He's coming off under his own power. Zaber, a fullback and defensive lineman. Seen a lot of playing time already tonight. Let's hope he's all right. Just shook up a little. Everyone's hypersensitive now to athletes' injuries, especially concussions.
Yeah, head injuries especially, that's for sure.
All right, Silver Eagles goal line defense out there with 3:19 and the clock running in the first quarter. Norskis with the ball on the MG 6-yard line. Sackman and Blum behind quarterback True. No, the snap directly to Sackman, the flag in the backfield.
Okay, so I don't know if there was an illegal formation or what there. The flag dropped in the backfield, the direct snap on the Wildcat to Sackman.
What do we have?
Yeah, legal shift. So that's
right.
Good.
That's good. That pushes it back a little. We'll take
that
5-yard
illegal
penalty.
Shift. Yeah.
Instead of first and goal from the 6, it's first and goal from the 11.
Boy, remember when Wanake used that Wildcat against Monona Grove in the playoffs?
They went just down the field all day.
They just wore the Silver Eagles out.
Wasn't that Austin Ramish?
Derek Strauss.
That's right, Strauss.
Derek Strauss, who's playing, I think, for the Badgers now.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yeah. Yeah, they just couldn't stop him.
Now, with an empty backfield, True by himself out of the shotgun. Wideouts all over the place. True, low snap. Rolling to his right, tries to throw into the end zone.
He's got his man. Can't tell who that is yet, but that's a touchdown.
Touchdown for the Norskis with 2:43 to play.
That was number 20. Was that Capistrano? Is that his name? Capistrano.
I couldn't see.
I think number 26, Capistrano, made the tackle, or made the touchdown. So. True's first completion of the game results in a touchdown, 11-yard score to Capstran.
Harry Aker, the kicker, ready to tie this one up or try to.
Another great name.
Harry Aker?
Yep.
Quarterback True, the holder. The snap, bad snap. True's got a scramble now. Weak throw.
I had no chance, and especially when trying to see who that was. Jarrett Meyer was laying him out as he was trying to throw.
Yeah, they were on top of that one pretty quickly.
So Monona Grove keeps the lead thanks to the bad snap.
7-6, Monona Grove holding on. 2:43 to play in the first quarter.
Well, a lot of action in the first quarter. A lot of plays.
I would say so.
The quarter has moved actually fairly slowly. I think it may be because of passing by DeForest. All incomplete passes until that last one. He had plenty of time to throw. There was no way that Monona Grove was going to be able to, the defensive backs were going to be able to hold their receivers as long as he had time to throw.
Big plays on that drive. Of course, the turnover that gave the ball to DeForest on the 50-yard line, but then that interference call.
Yep. And on a 3rd and 5. Yeah, took a pass interference call. Took DeForest down to about their own 26-yard line, the Monona 26-yard line, and then Sackman ripped off a 20-yard run, and the rest of it was story.
All right, Blang, Naherniak, and Kapuch back for MG. Harry Aker ready to kick it off for the Norskis. Now that we know his name, I'm going to say Harry Aker every chance I get.
That's a great name. God, they got good names on DeForest.
Connor True?
Yeah, really.
Kind of a short kick. Kapuch will take it at the 18-yard line. Up into the middle of the field, cutting it to the left side. Got a little running room. Gets out to the just shy of the 35-yard line where the Silver Eagles have it first and 10.
He had a big crease opening up to the sideline on that play, but he opted to go to the inside instead.
All right, the ball to the 34-yard line of Monona Grove with 2:36. The Silver Eagles clinging to a 7-6 lead over the Norskis. Kelsey and company back out on the field. Nugs to the far side. Kelsey under center. This is Naherniak in motion. The gift to Torin Young. Torin into the line. 3 yards perhaps. Let's see what kind of a spot we get.
So that dive play was a setup for a pitch to Neherniak.
I saw Neherniak go behind the quarterback.
Yep. Yeah, Kelsey gave the ball to Young, but he could easily pull it back out and flip it to Neherniak. Neherniak has got sprinter speed out there. If he makes the corner, he's going to be tough to bring down.
Well, let's see if they do it this time. Neherniak, the wing on this side, and then the far side receiver. I think that's Brady Blang on the other wing. Torin Young behind Kelsey. This is Brady trying to find some running room to cut it up and does not find it. Might have even lost a yard on that one. We'll see what kind of a spot we get. Yeah, they're going to put it back to the 37-yard line.
Yeah, Bland carried the ball three times for 27 yards last week.
Third and seven for the Silver Eagles. Will says we're doing good, Bob.
Oh, there he is. All right. I thought he was at the community center running the show from there.
125. We'll go there halftime, yeah. Bob. The WMVO halftime show.
Oh yeah, he wanted to go out for beers already?
Not at halftime. Kelsey chased and brought down in the backfield.
Boy, just that pocket was essentially non-existent. That was number 19 making the sack. Let's see if I can get a name on that. Bryson Girton, obviously Connor's younger brother. Yeah, no pocket, no protection at all on that play on that sack.
And that'll bring out the punting team for the Silver Eagles. Abraham Schradl deep for the Norskies. Larsh, the punter, remember last time when his first punt of the night, laid it out of bounds at the 6-inch line. Laid it out of bounds just shy of the end zone.
Yeah.
He's got a little tougher kick now.
He'd have to live up to his name to hit one like that this time.
Yeah, he's got to get almost a 70-yarder to get the end zone now. High snap, he pulls it down. Decent kick.
Yeah, good kick.
It's going to roll inside the 30.
Yep, and very good.
Down at the 28-yard line. Nice kick.
39-yard punt there by Larch. But there's a flag down. Let's see what the call is.
Down right around the 50-yard line.
Usually that means an illegal block.
And they'll tack that on?
Let's hope. We haven't gotten a signal yet. Waiting. Holding. Oh, yep. He's changing his mind here a little bit. Yeah, it's going to be holding against DeForest. And
just
so that'll back him up another 10 yards.
We'll take that. The ball was already down to the 28-yard line. Putting him back within the 20 suits me just fine. 16 seconds left, a personal foul.
Ooh, even better. That'll drive him back inside the 15.
So 16 seconds left in a long first quarter.
Wow. What?
Back to the 18. I guess it wasn't as egregious as we had thought,
yeah,
Bob.
That must have been holding. I think they were incorrect. The field announcer was incorrect on that one.
That's
a holding call.
First and 10 from the 18 for the Norskies.
I'm right,
under
he's
center.
Wrong.
Blum, the fullback. Sackman, the tailback in the I formation behind him. The gift to Sackman, left side. Boy, he pushes hard, but not much there. He might have got 3 or 4 yards on that carry. And that'll do it for the first quarter. 7-6, the Silver Eagles lead, the DeForest Norskies. Last year, Bob, I was looking at it, the Silver Eagles in their 11 games scored 146 points in the first quarter of all their games.
Yeah, I have that somewhere too. Yeah, that is.
That's a remarkable figure. That's
really
almost
is.
Half their total. Let's hope they score a little more than half that, or they've scored more than half that. I can't talk. You know what I'm trying to say. I want them to score a bunch more tonight, and this to be more than half their total. Man,
ladies and gentlemen, professional radio.
I had a thought. It wasn't well formed. I wanted to make a point.
That's classic. All right, yeah. This is the kind of stuff that you can look forward to the rest of the season here, folks.
Another 20 years, right, Bob? I can't believe we've been doing this 20 years, and this is all the gooder we are.
No kidding. We've really improved.
Yeah.
Well, that's
and
why
we
they...
And we dance even better.
That's why they keep doubling our salaries, Dave.
That's right. You only get this sort of flavor on local radio, Bob. You don't see this in the pros.
And you only make this kind of money on local radio.
That's right. So, a fresh 12 minutes on the clock. They bring the ball back. Where is it? 21, I believe it's going to get set at.
Yes, it will be.
Where it'll be second and
seven.
Seven for the Norskies.
A between quarter shout out to my friends out in Cottage Grove, Scott and Linda Smith. They tune in often to our games, so it's
really.
Yep. So
wow.
I want to make sure I do give them a shout out at the start of the season. Linda's always said nice things about us, Steve. So that's the kind of people you want to keep happy.
Yeah. All right, DeForest finally coming back out onto the field.
Oh, that's funny.
DeForest Durskis, come on. You saw where my brain was going.
Oh,
all right, wideouts all over
it's
the place.
Like it's like an accident scene in here.
Connor True out of the shotgun, Sackman next to him. Three wideouts, one of them in motion now. True looking to throw. Chase now.
Getting good.
Rolling left side or right side and throws it away.
Wow, very good protection for True. Had all day to throw back there. Tough conditions to throw in. I'm surprised that Coach Minnick is having True fade back so often.
One out of six so far, and that one was the score against the Silver Eagles.
11-yard touchdown pass.
That brings up third and seven. Big play for the Silver Eagles coming up. It's number 53. Quincy DiLoretto comes into the game. .11:53 to play in the first half, Bob. A 7-6 MG lead. I'm really hyped for this halftime show. No, I am.
I'm looking forward to halftime, too.
There's a lot of interesting programming on WVMO, and this is a chance to hear all about it. Connor True out of the shotgun. Looking to throw again. Swings it out and overthrows number 40. Bo Gaston. Gaston missed one earlier. That'll bring up fourth down and bring on Dryden Van Schryk to punt.
Well, you know, DeForest is surprisingly not riding their horse. I mean, he's carried the ball eight times already.
How many yards?
That's
he's
a lot.
A nice 50,
51 yards.
Yeah.
But I'm surprised they're not using him more. And Tyler Blum is no slouch either. He had a good year last year. I'd have to look and see what his numbers were last year. But he was no chump.
All right. Van Schryk ready to punt. Deep for the Silver Eagles. Is that Neherniak? I can't see. Now a flag. A couple flags.
I take that back. Tyler Blum only carried the ball 12 times last year. Oh, well.
That's once a game.
I thought I knew what I was talking about, but I often do.
Illegal procedure against DeForest, so that'll back it up even more. Another 5 yards tacked on. Yeah, that's Neherniak set to return the ball. He's standing near his own 45-yard line.
Third penalty of the game already on DeForest.
Silver Eagles looking to get good field position out of this exchange, unless Van Schryk can get off a boomer of a punt. Pressure coming. Ooh, almost blocked. Van Schryk, a low kick. That'll go out of bounds near the 50-yard line.
Okay, well, they got their field position back. Right around the midfield stripe. Forrest only flagged twice last week, three times already tonight.
49-yard line, first and 10 for the Silver Eagles. 11:43 left in the first half of a 7-6 MG lead. Silver Eagles with a golden opportunity here after the short punt. Wideouts to both sides. Young, the fullback, the tailback. He'll get the handoff straight up the middle, pushing the pile, powering, and now pushed back.
Leading the way for Young on that one was number 73, Michael Prebusch. Remember, Michael played a lot of offensive line for Monona last year, too, so he's a veteran performer out there for the Eagles.
I believe that's number 22, Chase Hatton, at fullback. Zaber got shook up. He is on the sidelines.
4 yard gain for Torrin Young gives him 21 yards rushing tonight. Been tough sledding so far for Torrin.
Yeah, he hasn't got into the backfield much yet. Kelsey calling the signals out of the I formation. The give to Young again. No, Kelsey on the keeper coming around the right side. Has the 45. inside the 45 and down near the 42-yard line.
Yeah, that one run to the short side of the field. A lot of congestion there. So Mitch only able to pick up not quite to the first down, but a pretty reasonable game.
Third and one. This is very doable. Third and one with 10:28 and counting left on the clock.
How about a halfback option pass?
No, let's not.
Remember when they pulled that out in the playoffs last year? Against Milton in overtime.
Yeah,
remember
that? Let's not do that.
Yeah, that didn't work so well.
We'll play to our strengths here, Bob. Oh, Kelsey lost the handle.
So now it's fourth and one.
Kelsey fell on it immediately, so no turnover this time. But after no fumbles at all last week, the Silver Eagles have lost two of them. Of course, in their defense, it is raining pretty good still, and that ball's got to be pretty slick. So loss of a yard on the play, fourth and two. Looks like the Silver Eagles might go for it. This is a test of a young coach. Does appear he's going to go for it. He's talking to Kelsey.
Yeah, I don't got a big problem with them doing either thing here, punting or going for it here. You got to see what your defense is made out of. Field is very wet. Connor True is having a hard time hitting his receivers, and they're going to call timeout and make that decision. little extra time to make that decision.
Saw some video of Coach Beckwith being interviewed after last week's game, and he says it's really interesting for him to be calling plays after being the defensive coordinator for many years. This is a real dilemma for a young coach. You know, we've got some inexperienced players out there, particularly at quarterback. We've got an inexperienced coach out there as well, you know, making these decisions. You know, it's all on him for the first time.
Right. But, you know, you also have to be, as a head coach, you have to be confident in your decisions, and you know that everyone you make is not going to be the right decision.
Oh, sure. You just try and reduce the chances.
And is it at this point in the game, Monona Grove's up 7-6. They only need 2 yards. It's been kind of tough sledding in the middle of the line for Torrin Young tonight. Would it be a good idea to punt? You know, it might not be a bad idea. Put DeForest back deep. The ball is wet. The quarterback's having trouble throwing it. They're not really gaining a lot of yards on the ground. They could make a mistake deep in their own territory and give you an easy score.
All right. The offense trots back out there, Bob. It appears they're going to go for it. Unless they do like a Randall Cunningham quick kick or something.
Yeah, one of those those rugby-style kicks.
Yep. All right, the ball on the 43-yard line of DeForest.
Yeah, they are not set up to do that.
Kelsey at quarterback under center. Straight eye formation to give to Torrin Young.
You got it.
Torrin has the first down inside the 40 and close to the 35-yard line. An MG first down.
Good quickness to get to that corner and a nice seal block there, it looked like, by number 22, Chase Hatton.
Five-yard pickup for Young. The ball placed at the 37-yard line. The official cradling it with a towel, trying to keep it dry between snaps.
So that gamble paid off, and so Coach Beckwith is now, you know, one for one in those.
Well,
kind
Bob,
of plays.
If you had to bet on anybody on the field making a first down on fourth and two, you'd bet Torrin Young could do it.
Of course.
First and 10 now for the Silver Eagles. The give to Young again, trying to go right side off tackle, runs into a little running room, pushed ahead, gets to the 35-yard line. Where he's brought down under 9 minutes left in the first half, a 7-6 MG lead.
A little too much penetration by Jackson Hemmer from DeForest for him to get it outside. Had to turn it back in before he wanted to and end up being a short gain.
Ball spotted right at the 35-yard line. Second and 8 for the Silver Eagles. Torrin's getting a few carries now tonight.
Up to 8 already.
Kelsey comes in with the call.
Remember, Torrin as a sophomore carried the ball 31 times in the championship game out of Camp Randall.
Remember that playoff game when he had 150 yards?
That was the same game there, buddy. 31 carries, 150 yards.
All right, double wideouts, I formation. Kelsey taking the snap, turns, rolling to his left, slings it out. First complete pass of the night. Who was that, Neherniak? No, 22, the fullback, Chase Patton.
That's a nice sling, too, because he
Chase
had to,
Hatton, excuse me.
He had to get rid of that ball.
MG first down. The ball just inside the 25-yard line. Call it the 24. That was just the first completion, was it not?
His first pass attempt. He went back once before but was sacked.
That's right.
So that's his first pass attempt. One for one. That's a good start for Mitch.
I'm okay with one pass per half. That's Dick Rundle football. A handoff to Young. Up the middle, some running room. Torin inside the 20 and pushed back. 5-yard pickup for the big tailback. Committed to Iowa.
I think that's actually a great decision by him instead of going to the UW. Iowa is, especially at this moment, Iowa's really had trouble finding a go-to running back. So that's going to be a great opportunity for Torin.
He certainly got the size. Be interesting to see how he performs at the next level. Second and 5 for the Silver Eagles. 7:08 to play in the first half. A 7-6 lead. Kelsey calling the signals. The give to Young again, and Torin Young still on his feet.
He's
blast
go.
The player in for the touchdown. 19 yards. Torin Young, his first score of the night. Adds to the Silver Eagle lead.
Well, the 4th-and-2 gamble pays off. Monona Grove finishes the drive in style with a 19-yard touchdown run by Torin Young. 13-6, Monona waiting for on the extra point here.
Colin Larsh, the boomer, set to kick this one.
Pretty simple play, just an off-tackle play there, Steve. But all the blocks were made and held long enough for Torin Young to get past that front seven. And once he's in the defensive backfield, they're going to have a hard time getting him down.
Yeah, there was only one or two players that even had a chance to touch him. They weren't going to get him. And the kick blocked.
Wow, really good penetration there.
So the Silver Eagles lead remains 13-6. We've got 6:52 to play in the first half. Monona Grove going back on defense now after the 19-yard Torin Young touchdown.
So Young coming off a 2014 season where he had a heck of a good season and was recognized for that. He was a first-team all-conference Badger South player. He was also the offensive player of the year for the Badger South last year. It's his second first-team appearance, also a first-teamer as a sophomore.
Last year when the Silver Eagles beat DeForest 21-0, Young was held to just 85 yards and no touchdowns. Well on his way to surpassing that tonight.
Young started slowly last year. He only went for a little bit over 60 yards in the first game last year as well, but it turned up his game as the season went on.
All right, Tradle deep. Up backs are 26, Capstrom, and 33, Blum. Larsh ready to kick it for the Silver Eagles. A low kick picked up by one of the mid-range blockers. Across the 35 near the 40-yard line. Not a bad return, actually. A lot of times those guys will just fall on the ball.
Very good field position for DeForest to start. They got to actually feel pretty fortunate. The missed extra point and now starting at their own 40. They could easily get right back into this game.
Oh, yeah, 6:48 left in the half. They put together a couple first downs. They could threaten to tie this game up. Ball right on the 40-yard line, 1st and 10 DeForest. True will bring him up to the line. Actually, I don't see True. Sackman out of the Wildcat. Three wideouts to the far side, one to the near side. Sackman off tackle, right side, has some running room. 50.
That's
Russ, 50, he's off to the races. Sackman could go 60 yards for the score,
wow.
And he does. Showing some nice speed there, picking his way through the line.
That Wildcat, man. that is a burr under Monona Grove's saddle, I can tell you that. That's actually a great, great offensive set for a guy like Jaden Sackman. Used to carrying the ball, has a lot of natural ability, a lot of gifts for picking the holes, and he's clearly got the athleticism to turn on the jets once he gets into the backfield.
He got a couple of good blocks and then just took off on that one. Now Harry Aker out there to try and tie this one up with an extra point. All of 12 seconds on that drive, Bob.
Yeah.
Nothing fancy either. True holding for Aker. Snap is down, the kick. Kind of a weak kick, but it gets it through and ties it at 13.
You only need to get it 20 yards, and you only need to get it about 12 feet in the air. You can make your extra point, and that's exactly about how far that went.
Yes, it did. So, with 6:36 left in the first half, it's tied at 13 here at John Clement Athletic Complex. Let's say it for fun, Bob. WVMO LP Monona.
Well, it's kind of exciting, you know. Monona's, they've got excellent radio talent that is helping this station get on its feet.
Yeah, and if you listen to some of the stuff that's been, some of the shows that have been programmed already, it's really some good stuff, a good mixture.
Yeah, so they got Lindsey Wood Davis, and they have Tom Tuber that are involved in this. I mean, let me tell you, these guys have spent many years in radio, and it's really, really gratifying to see guys like that are volunteering their time to essentially get this baby going.
One of our classmates, Jim Gunderson, does a show on British invasion-themed music.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, I guess it's gone pretty well so far.
Oh, good, good. Let's not forget Will Nimmo. He's really the nuts and bolts behind
this.
He's the media advisor for Monona, and it's his job to make everything work.
Akers kick. Ooh, fumble near the 20. Picked up. And we're not going to get much more than that. Capuch trying to return that one and bobbling it. So the Silver Eagles starting off in a fairly deep hole near their own 20-yard line. 6:29 to play in the first half.
Yep.
First and 10.
Let's see if Monona Grove can get their running game going.
Still just a steady rain still coming down, Bob.
Still 6.5 minutes to go in this quarter. Has this seemed like kind of a long half?
This has seemed very long.
Lots of football going on, but the time is, I don't know if it's just ticking off, you know, every second takes three or what the deal is, but things are going slowly here in the first half. Usually when you got teams that feature running games, the clock just never stops.
Kelsey under center. To give to Young, trying nice to go right block. Side. Has a little running room if he can get the corner. 35, 40, 45, 50. Out to the 50-yard line before he's brought down.
Terrific blocks at the point of attack. Just terrific blocks. Nook with a great block. And then Chase Hatton, I believe, with another great block. And once, as we've said more than once tonight, once Torin Young gets in the defensive backfield, he is tough to bring down.
30-yard pickup for the senior. Looking for his third consecutive 1,000-yard season.
I don't think we'll have any problem seeing that happen.
First and 10 for the Silver Eagles out of the I formation. Herniak split to the far side, Ning to the near side. Give to Young, off tackle. Powers his way for 3 or 4 yards, now pushed back. Gets it into DeForest territory where it'll be second down. Clock continues to run, 5:45 left in the first half. 3-yard pickup for Torin Young. They're going to get real tired of seeing Torin Young coming at them. At some point, you continue this beating, those defensive linemen get worn down, and it's hard to chase him.
And they have very big defensive linemen. Usually that's a plus, but if they're getting moved off the line, they're just going to get more and more tired. Oh,
fumble.
Another drop one.
And Kelsey falls on this one. We lost a yard on the play.
Going to have to be a little more careful on those exchanges at the center quarterback position. That ball is slippery.
That's a third fumbled snap. Kelsey wisely just dropped straight down on it, but that makes it 3rd and 9.
Yeah, loss of 2 on that play. Yeah, they're going to have to be a little bit more cautious when they're taking that snap. They have to just, Mitchell just have to hang in there for just another beat to make sure he's got a firm grasp on the ball.
Well, you know, it's only his second game at quarterback. I'm sure he's pretty anxious. He wants to get the ball to Torin Young as quickly as possible. We all want him to do that. Now he drops back, throws, swings it out. Almost intercepted. Off the hands of number 12. That's Hunter Wilson, a defensive back.
Looked like he had a Herniak open in the seam there, but he overthrew him.
That'll bring up 4th and 9 and force a punt. Colin Larsh will kick it away for the Silver Eagles. 4:21 to play, a 13-13 tie game. Schrodel back for the Norskis, standing near his own 10-yard line. Let's see what Larsh does with this one.
Yeah, got to get a good snap with this ball. I could see a bad snap happening on to either team tonight on a punt. Pretty good.
Nice kick. Schrodel, take it at the 11. Caught and dropped.
Yeah.
Just over the 15-yard line. Nice coverage.
Nice play. Let's see if we can figure out who made that tackle.
Maybe a 5-yard pickup at best on that return.
Looked like to me number 33, Jabin Nielsen, might have made that tackle. It's hard to say. The numbers are hard enough to see, and now that they're getting wet and a little bit dirty.
The ball at the 17-yard line, first and 10 for the Norskis, 4:08 to play in the half. Two outstanding runners tonight, but they've each only seen the end zone one time.
Yeah, they're both playing each other pretty even, too. Over 100 for Sackman already.
WVMO-LP, Voice of Monona. It's 8 o'clock.
I heard your phone go.
I think that was Sackman into the line on that play.
Yeah, hardly any gain, though. Very short gain.
Yeah, give him 3 yards on that. It's 2nd and 7 now for the Norskis. Clock continues to run. We're under 4 minutes to play in the half.
You probably didn't know this, but this is Jaden Sackman's 15th consecutive 100-plus yard gain.
I did not know that. That goes back to a couple years ago.
Yeah.
Wow.
Back to his sophomore year. He was just a part-time player his sophomore year. He racked up a couple of 100-yard gains at the end of the year in the playoffs.
Can certainly see why they go to him now. True out of the shotgun with Sackman next to him. Double wideouts to the near side here. There's a man in motion. The handoff to Sackman again, sweeping the end. Has
nice
some
hole.
Running room. Tries to jump over a player. Has the first down.
That was Tyler Patton that made the tackle.
Patton went low, and Sackman tried to hurdle him.
Gain of 12 by Sackman. That's a first down.
First down from the 32-yard line.
Yeah, he had a nice hole to run through.
Patton saved a touchdown with that stop, though.
Yeah. Yeah, he had some air under him, too, when he made that leap.
Dryden Van Schroik going split out far to the other side. Connor True splitting out wide to the near side. Sackman out of the Wildcat. Now there's some discussion in the backfield.
And they're going to call timeout.
Yeah, they're a little confused here.
Yep.
They're in the Wildcat formation. Connor True didn't appear to know where he was supposed to be. 2:48 to play. We've got a timeout.
Well,
tied at 13.
I know where Connor True didn't need to be, and that would be back next to Sackman in the Wildcat.
No.
Especially after the last snap to the Wildcat.
Yeah, I remember that
Sackman
one worked pretty well.
Sackman doesn't need any help back there.
That one must have been the one that put Sackman over 100.
Yeah, that 60-yard run, it helped. Helped a lot.
2:48 to play in the first half. Steady rain coming down still. The ball appearing
13,
a little slippery
yeah.
out there.
Well, this is as close a game as we thought it was going to be. Monona Grove has never lost to DeForest. 4-0 against DeForest.
Yeah, we mentioned they beat them 21-0 last year. All 21 MG points coming in the first quarter. Steve Martini throwing for one. Throwing for two and rushing for one.
Yeah. Yep, one to Jackson Riley, and then one at the end of the first quarter to Torrin Young. 40-yard touchdown pass to him.
Jackson Riley, the tight end, defensive end, gone on to play at the college level. Is he Northern Illinois?
I think he went to Duluth, if I'm not mistaken.
I thought he was an Illinois school, but whatever.
It doesn't matter. That's where I thought
he was. All right. Is this Sackman out of the Wildcat? Yes, it is.
Oh.
Has some running room across the 40, across the 45, and dropped short of the 50.
That's who made the tackle back there. I think that was Jarrett Meyer. Jarrett Meyer on the tackle, and it's a good thing he made it because he was the last man standing between Sackman and the goal line.
Another first down for Sackman and the Norskis. The ball out to the 48-yard line. Now Connor True will step under center as they go back to the I formation. I don't know. That Wildcat seemed to work pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
Hand off to Sackman again. This time he's hit and brought down, short of the first down at least, but a nice pickup as he got 6-7 yards on that carry.
Powerful runner. Powerful runner. Runs with his knees high. The tackle was made, looks like, by Keontae Ferge. And I think he caught a knee in the old coconut there. It might have been Guyette. Yeah, I think it was Ross Guyette. Got up slowly.
2 minutes to play in the first half, still tied at 13. Out of the shotgun, Sackman, the Wildcat, still on his feet, has the first down, struggles and stills on his feet, bouncing off players, brought down from behind by number 43, Tanner Dahlhauser.
I mean, he got met. I mean, met 2 yards into the Monona Grove defense, and then he just shook that off and ended up running through an arm tackle, gaining 22 yards on that play, Steve.
First and 10 at the 30-yard line of Monona Grove, minute 35 and counting.
Boy, if they don't get a handle on Sackman, he's going to be 200-plus here in the first half.
All right, Connor True with an empty backfield out of the shotgun, looking to throw. Rolls to his right side, slings it out there, caught.
A good enough pass to get caught, an open receiver in the seam on the right side there.
Jacob Capstron making the catch. And we've got
a Monona Grove Silver Eagle down. So that'll stop the clock. Good for DeForest that that clock stops. Looks like the ball's going to get placed at about, what, the 17 there, huh, Steve?
Yeah, that's what it looks like.
13-yard gain on that pass completion.
Yeah.
Capstron's second catch of the game.
Minute 12, that's number 17 for the Silver Eagles. David Mann's coming off holding his arm, or his hand. He's going to get looked at on the sidelines. So the ball placed at the 16-yard line, the scoreboard says.
Hopefully.
First and 10 with a minute 12 to play in the half.
Yeah, hope Mann's injury is minor. When he came back to the game, he'd be a big loss to the Silver Eagles.
High formation for the Norskies. The give to Sackman. Runs in the line, bounces off, trying to get outside. He's got a little room. Brought down near the 10-yard line.
Good pursuit, and then a nice tackle by Jarrett Meyer. We've been calling his name a lot tonight.
Dahlhauser also in on the stop.
Yeah, coming up from his safety position to make the stop. Nice job by Sackman. Didn't have anywhere to go inside. Took it back outside. Looked like he had some daylight, but Meyer came up and took his legs out from underneath him.
Second and 4 from the 10-yard line. Sackman out of the Wildcat again. Sackman looking for some running room right up the middle. Has the first down. Stopped short of the end zone, though. 25 seconds left. They're going to have to stop the clock here, I would think. There it is. First and goal for the Norskies with 24 seconds left in the first quarter, or first half.
I love that Wildcat with this kid. And he just stands back there, and it's going to be a running play. He's not going to throw. Everybody knows it, and he just stands back there, finds that little gap, and then hits it, and it's just
out of the eye. True drops the ball, hands off to Sackman, and Sackman's
nice
stopped for a loss even.
Yeah, Adam Scaife, I think they'll call that no gain, Steve.
No gain, you're
Adam
right.
Adam Scaife, number 52 on the tackle, and need we say it? Oh, this time it's number 6, Tyler Patton, with helping out.
DeForest using their final timeout, 10 seconds left on the clock, so they'll have time to get one more playoff probably.
Yeah, they gave him a yard gain on that, it looks like.
Now the scoreboard is, I don't know if the officials are.
Right. Yeah, we're going to go with no gain on that play.
Let's go with no gain on the play.
10 seconds to go here. You know, a running play that gets stopped here is going to end the half. So I think DeForest is almost going to have to. Well, they're either going to get one running play or they're going to have to throw the ball here on second down.
And, I mean, throwing the ball hasn't worked all that well for them, although they have scored a touchdown doing so. But
right, and they completed their only pass on this drive. I'd say you throw it on this one, and then whatever happens, if you don't complete it, it's incomplete, then you have one play left no matter what. Then you can always run the ball, unless you take a sack. If you take a sack, then the half ends.
Yeah, I don't know if True should throw the ball on this one. He's shown the tendency to hold on to it a little long.
Yeah, 10 seconds. If they run a little run out, and I'm sure Coach Minnick will tell him, listen, you just got this amount of time.
Yeah, you've got two steps to throw.
If you get to 5, you got to get rid of that ball, just throw it out of bounds.
All right. Second and goal from the 3-yard line. 10 seconds left on the clock here in the first half. Sackman in the I formation. No, out of the Wildcat.
Okay, well, they're going to run the ball. At least you
know
what's coming.
And a timeout called by the Silver Eagles.
Let's say at least you know what's coming.
Yep.
And I love the spread offense there in the Wildcat. They get all the rest of their potential ball carriers out away from the interior line, and that is going to spread out the Monona Grove defense, going to make it even easier for Sackman to find that gap and hit the end zone.
Yeah, you can have your corners cheat a little, come inside on the guy they're defending, but
right.
you can't stop the ball in. You can't stop the run inside.
Yeah, exactly, and if you do cheat your defensive backs in and let somebody go out there, Sackman always has the option in the Wildcat to actually throw the ball. We've seen him throw the ball once tonight from a tailback option pass, so he can throw it. I'm sure he's not looking to throw it. I'm sure he's looking to run it. So we got a timeout here by Monona Grove.
10 seconds left on the clock. Pretty exciting game for our first
right.
radio game here on WVMO with Voice of Monona.
This is an exciting play, too. I mean,
Monona
gets the stop, and it's tied at halftime. They don't get the stop, and they go into the halftime down by a touchdown. I mean, it's that easy.
Monona back out onto the field. Here come the Norskis. Well, let's see what Coach Minnick dialed up for this one. I don't see Connor True. They're going to have Sackman out of the
Wildcat. Yep.
All right.
Only two guys split out this time.
He's got his fullback on the wing to the right side. He tends to go that way, looking to throw. Slings it into the end zone. Incomplete. The Silver Eagles get the stop.
But
no, 4 seconds left.
But that's the beauty of throwing the pass there.
That's what you were calling for,
yeah,
Bob.
Yep, that's
so
the beauty of it. They still got that shot. They can still go right back to the Wildcat, and now he can try to power it in.
Nope, they're bringing Harry Aker out, Bob.
Oh, they're going to kick a field goal.
They're going to try to kick a field goal.
All right.
This is not much more than an extra point.
I got to say, that's one I didn't see coming.
No, I would have thought with Sackman, they would have tried to run it there. But
yep.
Harry Aker will attempt the 20-yard field goal
okay.
with 4 seconds left. Connor True, the holder. See if the Silver Eagles can disrupt this one enough to go into the locker room
yeah.
with a tie. Still,
yeah.
I consider that a moral victory, holding
this,
them.
This kicking game is not automatic. This is not something that you can just put on the board.
High snap.
Oh,
Connor True looking to throw. Chased.
And done.
And sacked.
That's Brady Blang on the sack.
Brady Blang with a big sack.
But
to go into the locker room at halftime.
That was Jarrett Meyer that forced the issue on that one. He was the one that held up the pass and gave Brady Blang enough time to come in and put Connor True on his back. I do not understand that call by Coach Minnick.
Nope,
now,
I don't
I
either,
mean,
Bob.
Why didn't you just, if you were going to do that, why didn't you just line him up in the Wildcat and go that route? I just don't get it.
A momentum shifter to end the first half. The Silver Eagles go to the locker room tied at 13 with the DeForest Norskis. Bob will be back after the WVMO halftime show.
Are we throwing it to halftime
we're
show?
We're throwing it to the halftime show, Bob. We'll
All
be
right.
back.
You
Stay
go,
tuned for the second half of Silver Eagle
go
football.
WMVO or VMO.
You got it. Voice
right.
of Monona. Welcome back to Silver Eagle Football. You're listening to WMVO 98.7 Monona. I'm Steve Martinelli alongside Bob Schmuck. And next week, the Silver Eagles are on the road as they travel down the highway a piece to take on the Oregon Panthers. Right now, though, they've got the DeForest Norskis to deal with. The score tied 13-13 at halftime. Bob, tell us a little bit about the first half.
Well, I thought maybe you'd run down the scoring for us.
Oh, I can do that for you if you'd like, Bob.
Yes,
first,
please.
On the very opening play of the game, Mitch Kelsey taking the ball 72 yards on a quarterback draw for the touchdown. Colin Larsh, the boomer, kicking it to making it a 7-0 game. DeForest, after punting on a couple of possessions, comes back after recovering a Kelsey fumble. They march down the field, and Capstrom taking an 11-yard pass from quarterback Connor True. The pass no good for the extra point, and it's a 7-6 MG lead. Then the Silver Eagles come back in the second quarter. Torin Young, a 19-yard touchdown run. That kick was blocked, so the Silver Eagle lead only 13-6. But then the Norskis coming back down the field. Most of it on – no, it was one play, wasn't it, after the Torin Young touchdown. Jaden Sackman going 60 yards on the Wildcat. Harry Aker kicked the extra point to tie it at 13. And then shortly before the half, the Silver Eagle defense holding strong, denying the extra – or the touchdown and – And then on the fake field goal, Brady Blang coming in with a big sack, retaining that 13-13 lead, and that's where we sit at the half. Now.
Yes. Yeah, now it's my turn, right?
It's your turn. Yeah. I'm going to have one of Dave Kirzner's cookies.
He's got to get his second cookie in.
That's right.
Yeah, we'll try to keep the chewing noises to
chomp,
a minimum because there's
nom.
Nothing more professional than chewing noises on the radio. So anyway, DeForest, they had a great chance to score and take the lead in at halftime. Second and goal at the 3-yard line. They had Jaden Sackman. Jaden Sackman had carried the ball up to that point 17 times for 182 yards. That's the first half, folks, 182 yards. We could be seeing a lot out of him in the second half as well. But for some reason, Coach Minnick from DeForest decided to not run him again. In fact, had him throw an incomplete pass and then try to fake field goal. And fortunately, for those two coaching decisions backfired, and Monona Grove stays tied. Connor True is the quarterback for DeForest, and he has struggled in the first half. He is 2 for 9. He has thrown a touchdown pass. He has been sacked. Most of his passes have not been terribly close. A couple of them have been, well, probably a water-related issue.
Yes,
there's
a lot of
rain out here.
It's very damp out there tonight.
All right. Let's turn to Monona Grove. Well, I think we all know who Monona Grove's leading rusher is tonight.
Let's guess and say Torin Young.
Good guess.
Has anybody else aside from him and Mitch carried the ball?
No. Actually, Brady Bland carried the ball one time and was stopped for no gain, but otherwise – Mitch Young is actually leading the way for Monona Grove tonight on the strength of that 72-yard touchdown run. He's run for 93 yards on 8 carries. Torin Young, though, 12 carries, 84 yards, and a 19-yard touchdown run of his own. Mitch has thrown the ball twice, completed one to Chase Hatton for 11 yards, been sacked once for a loss of 5. Back to you, Steve.
Oh, I'm not prepared to say anything,
no,
Bob.
No, I got that.
Yeah.
So you were talking about, Steve, Darren Schwen and how he's the all-time leading rusher for Monona Grove, and he owns the single-season record as well, right?
That's right. Darren ran for over 1,700 yards in the 2004 season, over 3,200 in his career. That's something that's surely going to be threatened by Torin Young this season, barring injury, knock on wood.
Absolutely. Torin Young comes into this game, or into this season, having run for 2,366 yards in his 2 years on the varsity, averaging 6.5 yards a carry, scored 26 touchdowns. And, Steve, he's carried the ball 369 times, and he's only fumbled 4 times.
Wow, that's pretty excellent.
Yeah, it really is. And at least one of them was in that championship game, and I think maybe 2.
Yeah, that's right.
Remember, because we just couldn't believe that he had dropped the ball because he hadn't dropped the ball the whole season.
That's right. Well, Bob, let's talk a little bit about Oregon, the team that we're going to play next week. They won their opener last Friday night against Sauk Prairie, 31-3. Senior running back Lucas Matthews with 3 touchdowns on 100 yards rushing and a 28-yard reception. Oregon could be much improved. They've been around 500 for the last several years. This might be the season. It's kind of a down year in the Badger South, by my reckoning. Silver Eagles, I think, should win it easily, but
I think
Oregon could slip in there.
I think Coach Kissling's got enough talent, and I talked to an Oregon parent just today, and he said the numbers are up on the team, which is always a good sign. They went for... Oh, gosh, how many yards did they go for last week? Quite a few, 282 yards rushing, another 384 yards total offense. Looked pretty good against Sauk. Sauk doesn't exactly present the stiffest of opposition. Did a nice job on defense, too. Only gave up 199 total yards on defense and just that single field goal. So Oregon will be a nice test for Monona Grove as their first opponent from the Badger South.
Well, let's hope we get some of our technical difficulties worked out, and we can do that road game on the radio. Bob will be with us, of course, but I'll find some way.
I might be for Oregon. That's pretty close, and I don't have any big plans next Friday. So
okay.
I could possibly be doing that.
You know, you're generally a pretty busy guy. I wasn't going to count on you.
I don't blame you, but don't tell people I can't be there when you just don't know.
Well, last I heard, you weren't going to be there. I wasn't counting on you. Last year when the Silver Eagles played Oregon, they defeated them 38-7. They took a, 31-7 lead at halftime.
Yeah, they played that game here, and I remember that game being over with pretty quickly. Pretty quickly indeed.
Oregon, nice to hear they've got the numbers up for the football program. They're one of the better boys soccer programs in the state. Yeah, I know that excites you, Bob. MG Boys Soccer won the other day.
Yeah, I saw that.
As did the girls' golf team and the girls' tennis. That's what it was.
Oh. Yeah, well, as a play-by-play guy, I count on you to know the scores and of the games for the other
sports. And then I feel really bad because I don't remember his name, but one of their teachers just won some presidential award.
Oh, man. Really?
Yeah.
This is the kind of homework you do before a game?
It was in the paper I was reading.
Tip of my tongue.
Before,
really? Tip of my tongue,
before,
Bob.
While I was eating my leftovers before leaving the house tonight, I was reading the paper.
You're eating your beans?
Eating my beans.
They're going to taste like steak if we win tonight,
Steve. We're going to win tonight, Bob. I can feel it. The defense is going to come out. They're going to stop this Wildcat. This Wildcat, Jaden Sackman.
Well, I'll tell you what, if DeForest is smart, they're going to use that Wildcat extensively in the second half. Monona has not proven that they can stop it. And in high school football, at least for my money, you just keep running it and running and running until they show you they can stop it. And that was the way Dick Rundle ran his teams out here. He ran a right 56, which is just an off-tackle play, and he ran that thing until the opposing defense showed they could stop it regularly. And then he ran it to the left side.
Well, and that's kind of the pattern they've taken tonight. We've seen Torin Young go right side off tackle many times. They're not doing anything fancy with a lot of those, just good blocking and strong running from one of the best backs in the state. Although I think we're seeing two of the best backs in the state tonight.
Yeah, it's very exciting. I was really excited to see this game just because of that. This kid Sackman, I read about all year last year. Even though Monona Grove shut out DeForest last year, Sackman got his 100 yards of rushing offense. So he, I guess, can't be blamed for that shutout.
No.
But he's the real deal, and he is a good-sized kid. Looks like he's got better-than-average speed. He's gonna make some noise this year in the Badger North, and I think statewide. He's going to get some recognition.
Absolutely, and he's got some good leaping ability, too, as he showed on that one play.
You know, Steve, he went for 1,900 yards last year and didn't even get a sniff at Offensive Player of the Year because – Max Myler was lighting it up from his quarterback position at Mount Horeb, and Troy Laufenberg was Mr. Everything at Wanakee.
That's right. They were co-offensive players of
the
year.
Yes, they were, and deservedly so. Troy Laufenberg rushed for well over 1,500 yards last year and also punted, kicked, and played defense.
Yeah,
he was a one-man gang for the Warriors last year.
All right, the Silver Eagles teeing it up to kick off to start the second half. Colin Larsh will do the honors. Welcome to the jungle, Bob.
Professional radio. I bet you that's on one of the shows, don't you think?
I bet it is. Yes. There's an Axl Rose hour.
There's
All right,
be.
Abraham Schrodel back deep for the Silver Eagles.
But you'd probably only get one show out of it.
I'll give you a little piece of WVMO trivia when we get a break here, Bob.
All right.
Larsh with the kickoff. A low, stuttering kick off the face mask of the up back, and he drops it at his knees at the 30-yard line. The trivia is, Bob, there's only one show on WVMO that runs longer than an hour. What is it?
Are you ready for this?
Yes.
I think it's Monona Grove football.
That's right, Bob.
And here we are, the voice of Monona Grove football.
Into our second hour, Bob.
There's the voice of Monona, and then there's the voices of Monona Grove football. That's us,
right,
Steve.
That's us. First and 10 for the Norskies from their own 30-yard line. They split out two to the far side, one to the near side. I think that's Sackman out of the Wildcat again. There he goes. Caught from behind.
Nope.
Still on his feet, though, and still pushing forward out to the 35-yard line. He is hard to bring down.
Yeah, he had at least three Silver Eagles on. Brady Blang had him. Tyler Patton had him.
He is hard to bring down.
Could not bring him down. He is a strong kid.
He doesn't seem to be having any problem with footing in this wet field. You know, he's getting plenty of speed going forward. He's not hesitating at all on his cuts.
Well, and we can say the same thing about Torin Young. He doesn't seem to have had any difficulty at all with the wet field.
No. Well, Torin doesn't dance either. He's straight ahead. All right.
Not like you, Steve.
Nope.
You dance.
Now we got a whistle.
And the call is...
I didn't see any flags.
Official timeout. A wardrobe malfunction out there.
All right, Sackman out of the shotgun again. Two wideouts to this side this time.
Showing a little too much ankle, I think.
That's it. It's a little daring man in motion. Sackman loses the handle on the ball, picks it up, and snowed under for a loss, pushing it back near the 30-yard line, negating the previous play pretty much.
I'm surprised we actually haven't seen more of that on both sides. I mean, Mitch Kelsey's had three center snap fumbles, but we really haven't seen that as much on the other side of the field. That was Ross Guyette getting in on that play, number 75. Loss of four on the play.
I thought I saw Grant Nelson in that as well. Third and nine now, just underway here in the second half. Tied at 13.
First negative yardage play for Sackman tonight on his 19th carry.
All right. Connor True out there now in the shotgun. Sackman next to him. Double wideouts to this side. One to the far side. True calling the signals. Looking to throw over the middle. Off the hands of number 40. Capstrom? No, Bo Gaston.
No. Capstrom was wide open on the left side of the field here. I mean, wide open. If True would have seen him and got the ball to him, that was six.
Well, that was a quick drop, and True was looking for Gaston over the middle immediately and didn't switch off his glance to anyone else. That'll bring up fourth and nine. Blang and Herniak will drop back to receive the punt from Dryden Van Schroik. It's hard to say that name and not smile, Bob.
I've smiled every time you've said it.
Dryden Van Schroik?
Yep. I'd see. I did it again.
Dryden Van Schroik?
Stop that now.
Pretty soon you're not going to smile.
No, neither are you.
The kick by Van Schroik. Bounce. Good roll.
Oh,
it's
nice
going to get
roll
down inside the 20. Herniak will let it roll, and the Silver Eagle offense will take over.
49-yard punt there with the roll.
There is a little bit of a breeze now, Bob, so it may have been somewhat aided, but
it
was still a nice
kick. Didn't look that good in the air, but it when it hit the ground, he got another 15 yards out of that.
He got a nice roll out of that one. The ball spotted just inside the 20-yard line.
That's one thing I have noticed about Monona Grove. The last few years, the punt return team lets the ball hit the ground a lot. Unless it comes right to them, they are not going to make that play.
All right, first and 10 from the 19. 10 minutes and 2 seconds left in the third quarter. Nigg spread out wide to this side. Torin Young, the tailback. Kelsey, the quarterback. They give us to Young. No, Kelsey on the keeper. This is the play we started the game with. Kelsey across the 20 to the 22-yard line.
About the opposite result, though. Boy, they were not fooled at all on that play, and they had a lot of traffic where Kelsey was heading, that's for sure.
4-yard pickup, though, for Mitch. Second and 6. Not a bad play, just paled in comparison to that 70-yarder. 9:33 to play in the third quarter. Tied at 13 still. Kelsey up to the line. Wideout split to the far side. Give to Young again, into the middle. Young, close to the first down, pushed back now. It's going to bring up third and a couple. Takes a minute to unpile these guys. Did you know Torin wears number 28 because he's a big fan of Adrian Peterson?
I did read that. And it was suggested to him by Coach
Adrian
Beckwith.
Peterson.
No,
oh, really?
Coach Beckwith, back when he was an assistant. Said, you know, you run a lot like Adrian Peterson, maybe 28's your number.
I don't know. I'd like to see him do a little beast mode. Third and 2 now for the Silver Eagles.
I don't know, Steve. You doing fantasy football this year?
Yeah, I got one more year in me.
If you can get Adrian Peterson, I'd take him. He's
I
well
probably
rested.
Would too. Yeah. Kelsey will give it to Young.
That's
again.
First
some
down.
Running room. Cross the first down. Out near the 40-yard line where he's wrestled out of bounds.
I don't know if you noticed there, Steve. On that play, Torin Young, when he got to the sideline, could have easily stepped out, saved himself a hit, instead put on that spin move that I think he does so very well, and decided to head upfield a little bit further. He took the hit, but he got another 3 yards out of the play.
Gets it out to the 42-yard line of the Silver Eagles. First and 10 with 8:15 to play in the third quarter.
And that puts Torin over 100 for the night by my unofficial scoring.
Why, that's two nights in a row this year.
Two nights in a row?
Two Friday nights under the lights. All right, a little discussion here by some officials on the near sideline.
Not sure what's going on out there. But I don't know. The head official out there looks like he's talking kind of smart to me.
Go over and talk to Van Schroik.
Yeah.
Dryden.
Yeah, yeah.
So I says to him, I says,
he's got Harry Aker over there, and Harry's got a gat.
Dryden's got the doll. Who's the doll? Look at the gams. All right, Kelsey up to the line. Next, we got to do radio dramas. Kelsey throwing it to the left side, incomplete.
Had an open receiver, just overthrew him on that. Zaber, the intended target on the play.
Nice to see Jacob Zaber back out on the field after getting shook up in the first half. That brings up second and 10. You got to throw every once in a while to keep them honest, but really their bread and butter this year is going to be Torrin Young.
Well, I think the 2013 team proved that you don't have to have, you know, a cannon arm to play an effective quarterback, and Tyler Blank did just that. Great game manager, great runner, but he was also a pretty decent passer.
Yep.
And he threw for a lot of yards that year, and that took a lot of pressure off the running game, him being him and Torrin Young and Brock Offerdahl.
The handoff to Young into the middle, powering for the first down. He blasted a couple guys there. 79 ended up on his back.
And let me look here. Number 10 it was. Alex Shoden got absolutely run over. I mean, completely run over.
Well, 79 is 6'1", 260 pounds, and he ended up on his back after colliding with Young. Like, he's still looking a little shook up there.
That was a very powerful run. I mean,
first down up the middle. Torrin Young takes him into DeForest territory.
This kid met him head to head, and he felt every one of his footsteps as it crossed over his chest.
The ball to the DeForest 48-yard line, first and 10, 7:45 to play in the third quarter. That was a fun run. They give us the Young again. Same play right up the middle. Inside the 45, still pushing now, shoved back.
Great push by the middle of the offensive line there. That was number 66, Cole Graffin. Oh, I'm sorry, Jacob Zell. And that was number, let me think. I think that was Casey McCoskey out there. No, I'm sorry, Jordan Builder out there, number 54. They had a great push in the middle of the line. Got helped Torrin get those 4 yards.
Second and 6 from the 44-yard line. Maybe it's time to do that little sweep with Herniak.
Yeah, they haven't busted that out tonight.
No, he split out wide to the far side now.
Only one carry by a player not named Kelsey or Young.
Give us the Young again, looking for some running room. Has the corner spin move down near the 40-yard line.
Wow, they were totally keying on Torrin Young there. Had great penetration by number 77, Alex Ewers, and by number 8, Jackson Hemauer. But Torrin Young just shook off that penetration, made a break for the outside, and ended up getting another 4 yards close to the first down.
Third and 2. 6:22 to play in the third quarter. Well, this is an interesting situation because they're going to key on Young. Do you go with him again, or are you trying to pull somebody else into the game?
What do you think, Steve? What did you say at least 2 or 3 times in the first half?
I'd actually fake it to him and let Kelsey run it.
Go to your horse.
And they do, and it works as he powers to the 35-yard line. Look at that. There's 4 guys hanging on him, and he's still on his feet.
I'm surprised they didn't whistle that, actually. They probably should have whistled it a few seconds ago. I mean, that's how you get hurt. You get stood up there. He wasn't actually making forward progress.
But they weren't bringing him down. He made the 35-yard line with 4 guys hanging on him. That kid is incredibly strong. I mean, I've been carrying you for 20 years, and that's been a chore.
Can't
imagine carrying 4.
Oh, my.
Oh.
Our listeners know the falsehood in that statement.
Eyes are rolling all over Monona.
Heavens to Murgatroyd. God, I think I just threw up in my mouth a little bit.
Think of all the eyes rolling in Monona right now. First and 10 from the 35-yard line, the Silver Eagles marching down the field. Remember, this drive started on the 19. All right, now they've got Herniak on the wing. Kelsey wanting to throw. Left-hander going deep over the middle.
Wide open.
Touchdown, Herniak.
Wide
open. From the 35-yard line. Mitch Kelsey with his first touchdown pass.
Mitch Kelsey had exactly 1 second to get rid of that ball after he reached the back of his fade because the rush was coming. He got hit as he let it go, but Herniak was wide open by 6 or 7 yards behind the defense. I don't know what. I honestly don't know what the defense thought was going to happen on that.
They're committing to the run. They've got to stop or try and stop Torin Young, and they had too many guys up, and Neherniak just outran the defender. Now Larsh will attempt the extra point. Frosting on the cake. And with that, it's a 20-13 MG lead. 5:14 to play in the third quarter.
You know, you can key on Torin Young, and it's a good idea because he's going to get the ball, but your free safety cannot be keying on him. He's going to be playing center field out there.
Yep, and especially with a player with the speed of Neherniak.
Yeah, he wasn't even in the same zip code as Neherniak. So, I don't know, a real defensive breakdown, and Monona Grove took advantage of it. A nice job by Mitch Kelsey to get rid of that ball before he took the hit. Got just enough under it to get it to Neherniak. That's Mitch Kelsey's first varsity touchdown pass.
Andre Neherniak, after scoring only one touchdown last year, has got two already this year after that run last week, and now the touchdown pass from Kelsey. We spotted Andre as a freshman. He got a couple plays out there, and we could see his speed
evident. Very fast, yep.
He's going to be fun to watch next year, too. So now Larsh will tee it up, and the Silver Eagles with that 20-13 lead will attempt to shut down the Norskies. Schrodel deep for the Norskies, although they've not kicked it to him the last couple of times. Gone for the knuckleball. This Larsh appears to be a pretty good kicker. The Silver Eagles had a decent kicker for the last 4 years in Drew Schuchart.
Yep, Drew Schuchart, all-conference kicker last year for Badger South.
All right, we're just about ready here. Larsh waiting for the ball.
Did you know that Torin Young is on the preseason watch list for the Elroy Hirsch Award this year?
I am not at all surprised, Bob.
And he's also the only Monona Grove player on the Wisconsin State Journal preseason all-area team. He was a second-teamer on the all-area team last year.
Behind Troy Loffenberg?
And there was a couple other guys there, too.
Certainly one of the best returning players in the state, no doubt. And he's proven that tonight, although this Zachman is definitely somebody to watch. Larsh's kick, another knuckleball up the middle.
Great idea with it's this slippery. But still got to make the tackle.
Yep, and they bring him down just over the 35-yard line. That was number 8 with the ball? Yes, it was. Number 8 for the Norskies is Jackson Hemauer.
Nick was on the tackle, and I'm trying to make out the number on the other kid here. If he'll just turn around for me, I think that was number 15, Frankie Langer.
Frankie Langer.
His second special teams tackle tonight.
5:08 to play in the third quarter, a 20-13 MG lead. Now DeForest back on offense, first and 10 from the DeForest 36-yard line. Connor True under center, the I formation, wideouts to both sides. The handoff to Sackman up the middle, plenty of running room. Almost broke that one. Ankle tackle, still on his feet. Gets across the 50 before number 35 for the Silver
Trying
Eagles.
Trying to see who that was. That
Grant Nelson brings him down.
I think that was Jared Meyer. We've called his name a lot tonight. Jared had him by the ankle.
And he saved the touchdown.
Sackman just dragged him at least 5 yards before he had to give it up.
15-yard pickup for Sackman to the MG 49-yard line. Oh, and we've got somebody down for DeForest.
Yeah, it's probably not Sackman.
It never works out that way, you know. Yeah, that kid is some runner.
Well, let's see. Let's see who it is. I don't see Sackman in an upright position. Is that him? That would be a shame. I mean, he's a great running back. I'd hate to see him get hurt.
Yeah, I was like going against another team's best. When one of their good players gets hurt, it feels like it cheapens the victory a little bit. Although I will take it.
And it was him, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That was
Sackman. Looks like they're working out a cramp.
He's got a cramp. Yep. Yep.
Well, he should have to come out for a play now. So they're going to have to give the ball to somebody other than Sackman. Boy, is he walking stiff-legged.
Yeah, it's obviously a calf cramp. He's got his ankle just locked in that L position.
Looked like a penguin walking
off
the field.
All right. Well, hopefully
they
can get him back in there because he's just a terrific running back. And I don't know if I'm going to get a chance to see him again this year, so I want to see him as much as I can tonight.
Yeah, you never know. We might see these guys in the playoffs.
And DeForest will be a D2 team.
Ah, that's true. And we'll most likely be D3 again.
Another D3, right.
All right. So now they come out with 3 wideouts to this side. True, the quarterback, in the shotgun formation. One split out to the far side of the field. man in motion going from right to or left to right. The handoff to Blum, the fullback. He's got some running room going around the right side, has the first down, and down near the 35-yard line of Monona Grove.
Yeah, Blum only stands about 5'9" or so, but I think he runs about 220.
Yeah, he's a bowling ball player. Listed at 5'9", 210.
Yeah. Give him about a 12-yard pickup on the play.
Well, they put the ball at the 39-yard line of Monona Grove, 4:25 to play.
First carry of the game for Blum. First carry for anybody not named Jaden Sackman.
Now Blum, the running back in the shotgun formation next to True. Sackman still on the sideline. Man in motion from right to left. The handoff to Blum. No, True going to keep it. Into the middle. Oh, he took a shot.
I'm not sure who got him. Let's see if we
75
can.
That was.
That was Guyette.
Guyette. He smacked True pretty hard.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, well, True earned his yardage on that one. He got three.
He got three, but he paid for it. That makes it 2nd and 7.
Yeah, he got stuck right in the chest on that one.
True brings the play in. Second and 7, 3:50 to play in the third quarter. This quarter going much faster than either of them in the first half.
That's for sure.
Not all those wasteful throws. Silver Eagles with the 20-13 lead. True, the handoff to Blum. Blum dancing about a little and hit at the line and dropped.
He got stuck at the line of scrimmage. Good penetration by the Monona Grove line. And I'm trying to make out who made that tackle.
Yeah,
might have been Dahlhauser. Kind of hard to tell.
I think Grant Nelson might have been in on that as well. So 3rd and 7, no gain on the play. Big third down call here. The ball on the 37-yard line, 36-yard line. Two wideouts to the left side, one to the right. Blum, the running back next to the quarterback, True in the shotgun. Throws
Get
it over the head.
All right,
throws it over the head of the wideout, number 26, Capstrom, and that brings up 4th down.
Very close to a lateral. As a defender, you have to get on that loose ball no matter what when it goes down like that. They did call it an incomplete pass, but that did not have a whole lot of forward motion on it.
And I think we're going to see the punt team. Wholesale substitutions here. I don't see Dryden Van Schroik. Oh, there he is. He's back to punt already.
Mm-hmm.
Dryden is Johnny on the spot.
Yeah, sure. They probably call him that at home. It's just Johnny.
It's easier than Dryden Van Schroik. All right. Nobody deep for the Silver Eagles. They'll let this one roll into the end zone. Van Schroik's kick aiming for the right
short pooch.
Corner. Player down there to down it.
And he did. Nice job. Smart play.
Nope, touchback.
Oh, he got in there. No kidding.
So
I
the Silver Eagles catching a break will get the ball 1st and 10 from their own 20-yard line with 2:47 to play.
See if there's any barking by the coaching staff over there, because I thought he got it before the ball reached the end zone. I mean, it's a break for Monona. I'm glad it got in there.
Yeah, no fooling.
Wow.
So the Silver Eagle offense will take over, a chance to add to their lead. Mitch Kelsey bringing in the play for the Silver Eagles. 2:47 to play. Well, here we were calling for Neherniak to get the ball on that last drive, and he got it, just not the way we anticipated. He splits out wide to the near side, Nig to the far side. Zaber, the fullback. The handoff is to Young. Young through the middle, has some running room. Close to a 1st down as he gets across the 25-yard line and near the 30.
Just a simple run between the guard and tackle on there. Probably even had a cross block. It's hard to tell down there, but got the hole he needed. Drove it forward for 8.
8-yard pickup for Young. How many does that give him?
133 by my count.
Another nice night for the senior tailback. Of course, that's only half of what he had last week.
There's still time, Steve.
Plenty of time left. We've got 2 minutes and 10 seconds left in this quarter.
He's
Nick's splitting out to
he's
the near
one
side.
Long run away from matching that.
Kelsey calling the signals. Give us to Young again, through the middle. 1st down, still on his feet, across the 40-yard line.
Steve, did you notice how quick he hit the hole on that one?
He
got to the hole, and then he did that spin move again, freed himself up for another 5 or 10 yards. Just terrific running. Boy, Iowa is going to get themselves a terrific running
back. Yes, they are. Now we've got a Silver Eagle down on the field.
Might be Neherniak.
All right, both teams will go to the sideline to confer with their coaches as the training staff will come out and check on the downed Silver Eagle, the grounded Silver Eagle.
13-yard gain on the play by Young. Just a really terrific run by Young.
Out to the 40-yard line.
Well, I'm going to take this injury timeout to also give a shout-out to another friend of mine and a Monona resident. Big hello and glad you're feeling better to my friend Malcolm Krennel. Malcolm is a colleague of mine at St. Mary's. Had what I would consider a very significant health crisis this summer. Has managed to shake it all off and got himself back to work and by all accounts doing very, very well. So, Malcolm, I'm glad things are going well for you. And hi to you and hi to Mandy. And I hopefully you guys are watching or listening tonight. But like I said, glad to see you back to work and glad to see you feeling very well.
Well, Bob, we were right. That is Andre Neherniak coming off the field under his own power. So hopefully just a minor injury here. Hopefully he can come back. And while we're stopped here, Bob, I'm going to take the opportunity to say you're listening to Monona Grove Football on 98.7 WVMOLP, the voice of Monona.
We should probably say, too, that Andre Neherniak was escorted off the field by Dr. Jim Shropshire, who's been the team doc for many years now. Mm-hmm. My condolences to Jim and the rest of his family. His mother passed away a month or two ago. A very nice lady. We knew her. We both knew her, Steve,
yes,
growing
we
up.
Did.
Just a class act all the way. She'll be missed. And once again, my condolences to Jim and Mark and the rest of the family.
First and 10 for the Silver Eagles. Neherniak gives to Torin Young. Torin, some running room, 35,
oh, nice block.
50, 40,
he could go.
30, 25, 20, 15, 10, 5. Pushed out of bounds near the goal line.
Oh, Will Nimmo, when can we have instant replay? I want to see who made that block out there.
50-yard plus run.
I did not get the number. It was just a terrific block, and that's what freed him up for that long, long run.
They're going to mark it at the 10, Bob, first and goal. So give him a 50-yard run on that one.
49er is what that was if they mark it at the 10. So, yep. About 49 yards. And Steve?
Well, the ball on the 11, they're saying. Just.
Yeah, I don't care what they're saying. I'm giving them 49 yards. Heck with them.
Nice run.
195 yards now.
Torin gets it again. Spin move into the line. He gets across the 10, maybe, pushed back. I think he spun a little early that time.
Well, you know, he has to be tired, but he gets to that line, and he still uses that spin move. That spin move takes a lot of energy to make that happen quickly.
Hunter Topple with the stop.
Yeah, essentially no gain on the play.
Yeah, he might have picked up a foot the way they're spotting it here. Let's call it second and 9 to be generous. Silver Eagles can get the first down, but I'd much prefer to see a score here. All right, Nick split out to the far side. Zaber the fullback, Kelsey the quarterback. All eyes on Torin Young. Kelsey juggled it, pitched to Torin Young. Torin cuts it back inside the 5.
That could have been a disaster. Those pitches are a lot of times timing plays. And when Kelsey dropped the ball and had to pick it back up, he turned and sling that thing back at Torin Young on a frozen rope. That's the kind of play that could end up being a bad, bad result, a fumble or even a DeForest guy standing there waiting to take the pitch himself.
I believe the ball is on the 6 now, Bob, so they picked up 3 or 4 there maybe, call it 4.
Yeah, let's call it 4.
Third. And no, I don't know. 6 it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
No, now we're going to get a timeout. Oh, that's the end of the quarter. Slipped away without me paying attention.
Well, there we are. We're done with 3, Steve, and I like the looks of this.
20-13 and the Silver Eagles threatening. Whoa.
That was the Torin Young quarter, I think, Steve.
Yes, definitely. They didn't do much. Except for the touchdown pass to Neherniak, I think Torin ran the ball almost every play, didn't he?
He did. He had 84 yards at the end of the first half. He's got 199 now, Steve. So 115 in the third quarter for Torin Young.
So Torin on the brink of back-to-back 200-yard games. Last week's 266 was a career high. Plenty of time to surpass that. I'd like to see him get a couple more touchdowns. I'm greedy.
I'd like to see for sure one more here in about the next minute or so.
Yeah, that would be nice.
That would be nice.
Well, remember next week, should we get lucky and all the stars align, we'll be broadcasting from Oregon High School as the Silver Eagles travel to take on the Panthers. The week after that, it's up to Reedsburg to take on the Reedsburg. What is
the
Reedsburg?
Beavers.
Reedsburg Beavers. Yeah. I should have remembered that.
You should have known that.
And then we're back here home on September 18th, Friday night, against the Edgewood Crusaders. Boy, I watched that game, Edgewood and Wanakee, on TV. You know, they do that delayed broadcast on Saturdays on 57, I think it is.
Oh, you mean this year's Wanakee?
Yeah, this year's Wanakee
game. Edgewood. Oh, God, Wanakee just stomped.
Yeah, Wanakee looked pretty good, and Edgewood looked pretty anemic.
Yeah, I don't expect much from Edgewood this year. Their brand-new practice field notwithstanding. You should see that, Steve. That is a gorgeous piece of work out there.
Yeah, they installed the turf, I heard.
Yeah,
all right.
$1.5 million.
Third and six from the 7-yard line, the Silver Eagles. Whistles all over the place. I'm guessing somebody jumped. We'll see what sort of call we get. Now it's 9 o'clock. WVMO LP Monona.
All right.
Oh, offsides against
that's
the Forest.
That is a great, great break for Monona Grove. This is a huge third down, and third and one is a whole lot easier to pick up than third and six. And I'm pretty sure we know who's getting the ball on this play, Steve. Or did you think it'd be a good time to fake it to him?
Nope. I give it to Torin. Third and two, let's call it, Bob. Kind of
it's
fat
never
two.
A good time to fake it to him.
No. You got a guy like Torin Young this close to the goal line, I'd say give it to him. All right, I formation, Kelsey the quarterback, Zaber the fullback in front of the tailback, Torin Young, the Tornado. Kelsey spins, gives it to Young, powers
touchdown
into the end zone for the touchdown, his second of the night. That was just powerful football, Bob.
It was. Just that simple little off-tackle play. Like I said, that's a play you run until the other team can stop it, and right now DeForest can't stop it. And you got to know that those big fellas on the other side of the ball there on the Norske defensive line are really tired. Monona Grove pushed that ball right down the field on him on this drive.
Torin Young's second touchdown puts him over 200 yards for the night. How many yards was that run, Bob?
3-yard touchdown giving him a grand total of 202 on the night.
So Larsh will attempt the extra point. Kind of a low kick there, but it is good, and that makes it a 27-13 MG lead.
Yep. It doesn't have to be pretty. It's just got to split the uprights.
Well, Bob, after taking that 13-6 lead and DeForest coming back and tying it to 13, I was a little nervous before the half, but the Silver Eagles with the big stop, and they have owned the second half.
I'm telling you, if the score continues to hold, the Coach Minnick and the rest of the DeForest coaching staff have to look at the way they played with 10 seconds left in the first half. They could have gone into the locker room with a 7-point lead and instead made a couple of, questionable calls and ended up going in tied. And you know they'll be kicking themselves if they end up losing this game.
I figured at worst they go into the locker room with a 3-point lead. You know, because that was a chip shot field goal. Most high school kickers should be able to make that one.
But we've already discussed the fact that DeForest kicking game, I don't know that there's anything chip shot, and we saw the one extra point he did make.
Are you
barely
disparaging,
got through it.
Are you disparaging Harry Aker?
Nope. I'm just saying the kicking game is not automatic and not on DeForest, and not very few high school teams have an automatic kicking game.
All right. The Boomer Larsh ready to kick off. We're just underway here in the fourth quarter. Deep kick this time to Schrodel at the 6. He's out across the 20, 25, 30. Little running room. Ooh. And brought down just over the 35-yard line. Good
nice.
Return,
yeah.
Almost 30 yards.
Yeah, great return, good field position. That could have that could have placed DeForest deep in their own territory, but a nice return. And actually, he was probably just a couple of steps away from making that an even bigger return than it was.
Yeah, so Larsh brings it out to the 36-yard line where the Norskies take over. 11:48 left in the game, a 27-13 MG lead.
Well, do we have Jaden Sackman back on the field? He left during the last DeForest series with
I believe we do, Bob.
Yeah, with cramps. Yep, and he's back out there, and they need him, and he's in the Wildcat.
In the Wildcat, yep. Two wideouts to the side wings. Man in motion. Gives it to Blum, and Blum slips and falls on his keister. You can say keister on the radio.
Yes, you can. That's not one of the seven words you can't say on the radio.
Boy, it was a nice misdeception play there with
no,
that Sackman.
Was, Tyler Blum was going nowhere, and that tells me that Sackman's leg is still bothering him. If he's handing the ball off in a Wildcat, there's no way that that would happen otherwise.
Loss of a yard on the play.
Yeah,
Connor True out there at fullback now out of the shotgun with Sackman next to him.
Yeah, Steve, I think even if Blum wouldn't have slipped, he was only going to get 2 or 3 yards.
True looking to throw, rolling to his left. Nobody out there.
Yeah.
Way underthrown, looking for Dryden Van Schroik.
And he was very well covered out there.
Yeah, double teamed.
That was Miles Thomas out there on the coverage.
Miles, another basketball team player. I like Miles. He and Kelsey are going to be good. Peyton Miller, another good ball player.
Well, DeForest can't let themselves get any further behind. They've got a full quarter to work with, so they can still use their running game. But if they have to turn to their passing game, I don't think they have any hope.
Yeah, I think if Sackman is out, they're in trouble. Yeah,
so you far, know. Sackman looks like he's still limping around back there.
He's on the field, but the first two plays have not gone to him, and that's probably the first time in the game they've run two consecutive plays where he didn't run the ball. Yeah, true to throw again. Over the middle.
You're looking for him.
Looking for Sackman, and he can't hold on to it.
He was open. Ball was thrown high. Thrown high and right over his head. He did get up in the air to try to make the catch. Came down empty-handed.
So three and out for the Norskies as they'll have to punt it away to the Silver Eagles. Dryden Van Schroik out there to kick it.
Yeah, just no click in the passing game tonight for DeForest. Connor True, 2 for 13 on the night.
Brady Blang dropping back to return the kick with Naherniak on the sidelines. Brady, a punt returner from last year. 11 minutes left in the game, exactly 11. Van Schroik, a kick, a low kick, end over end. Lang will let it bounce, and it'll die at the 29-yard line where the Silver Eagles will take over first and 10.
We should report that David Manns is back on the field, obviously able to shake off that earlier injury.
Andre Naherniak trotting out to play wide receiver too, Bob.
So Monona Grove with no game-ending injuries so far tonight.
10:49 to play, 27-13 Silver Eagle lead. Let's get one more for insurance here, Bob.
Oh, absolutely. And I said this the last time Monona Grove had the ball, but these big fellas on the defensive line for DeForest, they are tired. They've been on the field a lot in the second half. They've been getting pushed around. And when you're carrying that kind of bulk, you got to get some rest.
Nig splits out wide to the near side. Naherniak, the wing, hand off to Young. Trying to pick a spot through. Gets across the 30, maybe to the 32-yard line.
Oh, that's a face mask.
And there it is.
Yeah, that should be a personal foul on DeForest. Number 12, it looks like. Hunter Wilson grabbed the face mask of...
Hunter Wilson, an all-conference defensive back last year, I believe.
Grabbed the face mask of Naherniak, I believe. Late in the play, probably after Young is already on the ground.
Yeah.
So that should be a personal foul and a 15-yard penalty. And the call is. Oh,
they're calling it both ways. All right.
Offsetting call, so they'll just replay the down. But I can't say that it was the wrong call. I didn't see what Naherniak did before the face mask by Wilson, but all right. I did clearly see the face mask by Wilson.
All right, this official apparently does not know what replay the play means because he's spotting the ball at the result of the play. Should go back to the 30-yard line.
Yes, it should. Offsetting penalties should be a replay of the down. Okay. Well,
yeah,
whatever.
They're calling it second down, second and eight. All right.
All right, we come into our senses now. Somebody said, hey, offsetting penalties, replay the down. Yeah, we've seen a few questionable calls in our 20 seasons here, Steve. So
just a few.
Yeah, this is. I guess this wouldn't be out of the ordinary necessarily. Okay, they're talking it over. Yep, offsetting penalties.
They'll get this right.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we got to go back to the original line of scrimmage. And,
all right,
and,
the official coming over to say.
No, we're going to just keep doing it the wrong way.
All right.
Okay, whatever.
We'll do it the wrong way. Second and eight. It's still our ball. We got another couple shots
okay,
at it.
Okay, then.
at it. Torin Young at the tailback. Kelsey, the quarterback, letting some time tick off the clock here. Silver Eagles being very deliberate here, wanting to eat up some clock with a 14-point lead.
This is the kind of thing that can draw an offside penalty, too. If he comes in and just barks out that first count, he could get somebody to jump.
He dropped the ball.
Oh, nice play.
The defense was right on top of Kelsey as he fumbled that one, but nice landed on it.
Good penetration there by number three, Kevin Rawls, defensive end.
We lost a couple more on that. The ball back to the 30-yard line. Timeout called by DeForest. 9:52 to play, a 27-13 MG lead. The Silver Eagles third and 10 from their own 30-yard line.
So that's fourth fumbled exchange tonight by Monona Grove, Mitch Kelsey.
And a lot of it has to be because of the weather.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Still, that's a little disturbing.
And it needs to, you know, one time, two times, yeah, you can see it. But three or four times, you need to take that extra heartbeat to make sure you got control of that football before you pull out from behind the center. All right, they're jumping around here at Monona Grove.
Jump up, get down. Hey, look for us on TV, Bob. Wave. No, I don't see you.
I don't see you either.
Ah, the glass is in the way.
Frosting me. 9:52 left in this football game. Monona Grove owns a 14-point lead, and they have the ball third and nine at their own 30-yard line.
Big third down play. The Silver Eagles hoping to extend this drive by a little bit and eat up some more clock.
Yeah, it'd be deflating for this DeForest defense to give up a first down here on third and nine because they really need to get the ball back.
Ning split out wide to this side. Behind the quarterback Kelsey is Zaber and the tailback Young from the 30-yard line.
Another dropped the ball again.
Dropped ball. Kelsey looked like he pulled away too quick that time. Clearly upset with himself, and that's the fifth fumble. You know, one thing that has struck me, Bob, is there haven't been a lot of penalties tonight.
No, there really hasn't. Monona Grove's been flagged once, and DeForest four.
All right.
Monona Grove, I think, only was flagged three times last week. Yeah,
yeah, they didn't have many.
And that's Monona Grove's, you know, last year they took more penalties than we like to see. I mean, they probably averaged about six or seven a game.
I can tell you that in a second here.
Yeah, I have that information as well. But
all right. Larsh on the field to punt for the Silver Eagles. 9:05 and counting on the clock. Low snap, picks it up off the turf, gets a good kickoff. So go out of bounds near the 40-yard line,
though. See where they mark it. I think if I was marking it, I would probably put it at about the 41.
Five penalties per game.
Is that what it was
last
year?
Right on the head. 55 in 11 games.
They put it at the 40.
First and 10 for the Norskies.
Pretty good mark for Monona Grove, 1 yard further back than I thought.
Well, the defense needs to step up now to preserve the victory here. They're up by two touchdowns. The big question is, can Sackman be effective? Yeah. He's on the field. He's next to the quarterback, True, in the shotgun.
Can Sackman sack up here? We'll see.
At two wide outs to this side.
He's at 198 yards.
There's gets the handoff there. He's over 200 across the 50-yard line, still dragging a Silver Eagle, as he gets inside the 40.
Very impressive.
Who
Grant,
was that? Nelson.
Grant Nelson
would not let go,
finally on the tackle, but it took him about 10 yards to bring him down. A great run again by Jaden Sackman. Very impressive. I've been terribly impressed by this young man tonight.
All right, Sackman out of the I formation now. Hunter True under center. Wideout split both ways and a flag. Guessing somebody lined up wrong.
Or motion, because everybody was moving.
Looks like it's going to go against DeForest.
And the call is offside on DeForest. So maybe their wideout lined up offside, hard to say.
Yeah, they threw it pretty quickly there. That'll bring it back to the 42-yard line. First and 15.
Fifth penalty of the game. Sackman over 200 yards tonight. Last year, Sackman went over the 200-yard mark eight times.
Wow. Of course, he ran for 1,900 yards. Yeah. That's something. True drops the ball. Hands it off to Sackman. Sackman hit immediately and dropped after a two-yard gain. Sackman got back to the 40, but it got hit hard. Connor True with a good recovery there. He dropped the ball on the snap and turned around, and Sackman was right on top of him. He was either handed off to Sackman or get mowed over by him. Second and 13, the ball on the MG 40-yard line. Man in motion, they give us to Sackman, trying to get some running room.
Great block.
Sackman got back to the original line of scrimmage plus a couple more. He strung that one out a long way there.
Yeah, he got a few yards. Capstrand is the one that made that happen with his block on Brady Blang. He just pancaked Brady.
4-yard pickup for Sackman. Third and almost 10. The ball on the 36, 37-yard line. 7:15 to play in the game and a 27-13 MG lead. You're listening to WVMO LP Monona. Saying it just for fun this time. No charge, folks. All right, True out of the shotgun. He's got Sackman next to him. Sackman slinging out this way. True throwing it incomplete.
Nice defense.
Looking for Dryden Van Schroik.
Van Schroik open just for a second. I think that was Tyler Patton on the defense, number 6. Yes, it was.
I think Jarrett Meyer was around the play as well, Bob. That brings up 4th and 9.
And they have to go for it with only just a little under 7 minutes to go here in the game. They're down 2 scores. They have no choice. You know, they didn't necessarily need to pick up the first down on that play. It might not have been a bad idea to go to the Wildcat on that and let Sackman pick up, 3-4 yards and make it a more doable fourth down.
True out of the shotgun with Sackman next to him. I suspect Sackman isn't 100%. True looking to throw again. Steps up. He's got to run it now.
He's going to get it.
He's going to get hit.
He's got the first down.
He slides
for sure.
And has the first down inside the 25-yard line. Big play by Connor True. Wise move there.
He's kicking up a whole lot of water, too, when he hit the ground. It is really wet out here, folks. That's Connor True's second carry of the game.
They haven't moved the yardage markers yet.
No, they called a penalty. Holding
against the Norskies.
Now, if that's beyond the line of scrimmage on the hold, that's a spot foul. If it's behind the line of scrimmage, then it goes back 10 from the line of scrimmage.
The flag is behind the line of scrimmage, Bob,
yep.
So they're going to go back from the line. Oh, that's a huge play.
Oh, in fact, it's going to be a spot foul from there. That's pretty awesome.
That is a huge penalty, Bob. That's a swing of about 25 yards.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Because he had the first down on that play. Instead, they're pulling it back. Wow.
And I haven't seen.
Wow, look at this. Back to the 40. 7-yard line.
Wow, a huge penalty.
Of DeForest.
Yeah, so you're talking about 25 yards to go here.
So watch for
first down.
Connor True to have to chuck one deep. He's got Sackman next to him. 2 wideouts to this side, 1 to the far side. Low snap, he picks it up. Looking to throw down the left side. Players there. Incomplete.
Good defense. I think that was Miles Thomas back there. Is that no?
Jarrett Meyer.
Jarrett Meyer on the defense. Nice job on that.
So the big penalty
and
the Silver Eagle hold comes up, and that might do it, Bob. 27-13 with 6.5 minutes left.
Still plenty of time left. I mean, they're one turnover away from being down a single touchdown. So I wouldn't count my chickens just yet.
I said it might. Silver Eagles will take over on the DeForest 47-yard line. A golden opportunity to salt this one away.
That penalty was an absolute killer for the Norskies. That was one they could not afford to take.
Yeah, because True made a nice play, got the first down with his legs, and then they pulled it back. Not only did they lose the first down, they lost 10-plus yards on top of that because it was a spot foul.
Yeah, they took it from behind the line of scrimmage. Wow.
So you go to 4th and 20-plus. This isn't a team that's going to make that up very easily. Now Naherniak splits out wide to this side, Nick to the far side.
I don't think Naherniak's getting the ball.
Nope, they're going to give it to the workhorse, Torin Young, and he plows into the middle across the 45 down to the 43-yard line. 5 yards for the big man. Four-yard pickup for Torin.
26 carries for Young tonight.
Big night for the senior.
23 carries last week. What did he do last year?
I was just thinking. Let me see how many
194 carries in his 11 games last year. Didn't
so about average, 18 a carry?
Yeah, didn't even average 20 carries a game last year.
Well, he's bigger and stronger this year. You'd expect him to be able to handle a load of 20-plus carries. Now Nagle split out wide to this side. Herniak in the slot out of the I formation. Young again. Little spin move. Gets trying to get outside. Ooh. No, and he'll lose a yard or two on the play.
Yeah, he spun out of the hands of number 11, Brad McKinney, but he still couldn't get any positive yardage out of that.
Just nothing there.
Loss of about a yard on the play.
Puts it back to the 45-yard line, third and eight.
And his first run resulting in negative yardage tonight on his 27th carry.
And he goes forward an awful lot.
He's a straight-ahead runner, that's for sure.
He's certainly not a dancer. You know, he hits that line hard. He may spin out of it, but the steps to the line are very direct.
He's got great footwork, but, yeah, you're right. There's not a lot of juking going on.
There he goes again, right into the line and nailed at the line of scrimmage. They were ready for him that time.
Yeah.
And that'll bring up fourth down. Silver Eagle punting team? Are they?
Oh, yeah, they should be punting.
There seems to be some discussion on the sidelines, though. Punting unit hasn't gone out yet.
No, you got it.
There they go.
Yeah, you got to get out there. They're just running some clock before they ran them out there.
4:35 to play in the game on a 27-13 lead. Silver Eagles were in this position last week against Mount Hoare Barneveld. Mount Hoare Barneveld scored, make it a 27-20 game, and then the Silver Eagles hung on to win. Let's hope it doesn't come to that. All right, Larsh ready to punt.
Well, they're going to have the all-out block, I would guess, on here. If I don't know why DeForest wouldn't be going
flag.
For it. Oh, delay a game. Delay a game on Monona. That'll back him up five.
Well, that's not the worst thing in the world if your punter can get off a decent kick.
He just needs to get the kick off. Just they cannot allow a block here. That could change the complexion
of
the game.
Yeah, you're right.
But, so the offensive line needs to just keep him out long enough for him to get the ball in the air. Only a single man back. He's got no protection back there, so they're playing for the block.
They're going for it.
Here it comes.
Nice kick. Taken at the 13. Across the 20. Out to the 25-yard line, and he's brought down. Good coverage. 4 minutes left in this one, Bob. Rain seems to be coming pretty hard.
Yep.
Hasn't let up at all this game.
So that was number nine from Monona Grove, Carmelo Curatola.
Carmelo was one of the quarterback candidates.
Yep, on the tackle on that play.
We might get a chance to see him at some point this season. All right, 4:01 to play the ball on the DeForest 25-yard line, first and 10 for the Norskies. Yeah.
DeForest now in the unenviable position of actually having to throw the ball.
And True looking to throw it. Flips
a little screen pass
out.
Uh-oh.
Sackman with some running room, almost slipped. Now brought down just shy of the 50-yard line, and a flag, a late flag coming in from behind the play. We'll see what that's all about. What do we got? Bob, before the game started, you mentioned that you thought it was fun to play in the rain. What part of this is fun?
Oh, it is fun for the players. It really is. You'd be surprised.
When you're slipping and sliding and the ball's greasy.
But the ball's greasy, and if you're a
– Oh, because you're a lineman.
Right. If you're not a skill position player and that ball's greasy, you can knock that thing out of there. Wow, long personal foul penalty, and that is a – Needless to say, kind of a dumb penalty.
15-yarder against
the
Silver Eagles.
Silver Eagles to take at this point in the game.
Puts it down to the 38-yard line and gives the Norskies a shot here. Blum split out wide to this side. I think that's Van Schreik to the far side. Sackman, the running back next to quarterback True.
Every single play I call here, it gets the ball into Sackman's hands somehow. Monona's had a lot
there
of trouble with him.
Oh, and they hit him at the line and hold him up, and there they're going to finish
gonna
him off.
Him. Interesting call at this point in the game.
I would do my best to get him out on the edge.
Exactly.
But that one ran into the line, and he got stood up at the line of scrimmage. In fact, he lost a couple yards on the play. The ball back to the 40-yard line.
And the clock running.
So yeah, 3:15 to play in the game.
Not helpful to DeForest's efforts here.
Still a two-touchdown Monona lead. Quarterback True out of the shotgun. Swings it out to Capstrom. Capstrom brought down not quite to the 30-yard line. It's going to bring up third. Third and about three. Ball at the 31-yard line. 2:45 to play. That clock really working against the Norskies now.
That was Jake Capstrom's third catch of the game. He's also scored a touchdown tonight.
Now we've got flags before the snap. We got somebody moving.
Let's hope. Yep.
Yeah.
False start.
That'll bring it back. That'll make it third and seven, third and eight.
Wow, the penalties all of a sudden starting to add up, Steve, after you said, boy, we haven't seen many flags tonight.
Well, I was talking mostly the MG side of things. The penalties really killing DeForest. But, yeah, back-to-back penalties are almost back-to-back.
Well, and now DeForest can't use the running play at all. They're going to have to throw on every single down.
The clock stops. No, the clock gets started with the ball being
placed.
2:20 to play.
Yep.
True, the quarterback out of the shotgun. Sackman next to him. Sackman started before the snap there, but no whistle. He got to the line and a little more, but not much. He squirted out close to the 30-yard line, but he's going to be well short of the first down.
Yeah, as much as I like to see this kid carry the ball, this is not the time for him to be doing it.
No.
If he's going to be touching the ball, it should be on throws.
Fourth and three from the 32-yard line. With 1:50 to play, Bob, safe to say this could be the game if DeForest can't make it?
Oh, yeah, safe to say. And it might be the game whether they make it or not. I mean, they're not stopping the clock. They have two timeouts left. Not sure why they're not.
Low snap. True picks it up. Thrown over the middle, loops one for Capstrom, I believe that is. Or is that Sackman?
Hard to say.
The pass complete for a first down.
That was Sackman on the catch.
First and 10 for DeForest. The ball, let's see, where are we? About the 13, 14?
Yeah, 19-yard pickup on the pass play. But there's still no hurry. I mean, they're down two scores. They haven't used a timeout. They're not using a no huddle.
Minute 25 to play and counting down to minute 20.
I'm not
a
sure what
touchdown
they're
MG
conserving
lead.
Their timeouts for, but.
They give it to Sackman again, and he's tackled. I don't understand that.
Clearly the coaching staff is just done. I mean,
now they call the timeout with a minute 5 to play. About a 2-3-yard pickup for Sackman on that one, but.
It's almost like they've acknowledged the fact that they're not going to win this game. I think that's kind of strange. I mean, they
had the opportunity.
They got the ball back with 4 minutes to go, and now there's 1 minute to go.
So they're
not going to have enough time to get another score.
Sure.
Even if they put this one in.
You put Capstrom and Sackman on the same side split out. You know, Sackman in the slot coming over the middle. Capstrom going downfield. One of them's going to get open.
Yeah,
I don't understand that.
That did not make any sense to me in that play call there.
With a minute five, the Silver Eagles poised to win their second game of the season.
Poor use of the timeouts. Just bad clock management here in this last series for DeForest.
I have to say, Bob, that I was worried when I saw the schedule and saw these two teams, you know, Mount Horeb-Barneveld followed by DeForest opening the season for the Silver Eagles.
Yeah.
I thought we'd be fortunate to go 1-1. Looks now like we're going to start the season 2-0 and perhaps able to run the table.
Yeah, I had a pretty good feeling about, you know, looking at it early on that the Monona Grove would prevail here at home. I was really on the fence. I thought they'd have to play just a terrific game to beat Mount Horeb, and it turned out they didn't have to. I mean, they played just well enough to win, and so they did. And now they're going to go 2-0.
Torin Young with 200 yards for the second consecutive game, two touchdowns to go with that. True, rolling to his left, throwing for the end zone, way overthrown.
And I'm not sure what the point of play action was on that. I mean, it's just a little wasted motion. I don't know why he's not doing straight dropbacks. I mean, honestly, they have to throw the ball.
And they've got to do it expeditiously. They can't waste any time with those rollouts. So with 59 seconds left, third and seven.
I figure, you know, if they got one timeout left in the way they've done things so far in this drive, well, why don't they just get the Wildcat out and see if Sackman can run this thing in?
No, instead they're going to go empty backfield. True out of the shotgun.
Capstrom's in the slot over here.
Low snap. Rolling right, True, looking to
run.
Throw. He'll tuck it in and run. He gets hit short of the goal line.
Short of the first down, I believe, too.
And we've got another timeout by the Norskies.
Their last
48
one.
Seconds left.
That's all
yeah,
I got.
I would agree with you.
That's all I got. They got 5 yards on the carry by True.
That brings up fourth and two, though, from about the 5 yard line.
And no more timeouts. So they got to put this ball in the end zone here. Otherwise, the clock's just going to run. And they certainly haven't shown any sort of, you know, searching for the word here, but there's just no hurry up to these guys.
Yeah, there's no quick score option on this team.
Yeah.
You know, they should have long ago
given
up on the pass.
There's just no urgency.
Right. They could have gone to just Sackman and the Wildcat and had better success than they've had. Oh, well. That's all right. We like it when our team out-coaches the other team.
Connor True's had a pretty decent series here, but overall his game stats are nothing special. 5 for 18.
Brandon Beckwith looking to go 2-0 on his career as head coach for the Silver Eagles. That's a nice start.
Well, kudos to all the people that came out to watch the game. It is parents' night tonight, so there were quite a few parents out here, but it has rained the entire game. This is one soggy mess out here, and well done, all of you participants
I'm
tonight.
Comfortable. How about you?
Oh, yeah. It's been a terrific game as far as I'm concerned.
Okay, True. No, Sackman out of the shot or out of the Wildcat.
He might have got the first down, but he didn't get in the end zone, so it won't matter. Clock's going to run. They'll stop it to place the ball.
40 seconds remaining. First and goal. Let's see. About the 1 yard line.
The one, yeah. So give them 4 yards on the carry, but it won't matter anymore. As soon as that ball gets placed, the clock's going to start running.
And there it goes.
But at least they lined up and they're ready to go.
Yeah, we'll give them that.
They didn't go to the
aspect.
Huddle. And he's in. I assume that was
Sackman. I don't see a signal.
Yeah, over here on this sideline here.
Nope, there's the other ref. Sackman for the touchdown with 29 seconds remaining. Sackman, his second score of the night. A little different than that 60-yarder he had.
Yeah, he had to work hard for that one. 29 seconds to go. You know, obviously an onside kick coming. And I think even if DeForest would recover, they'd have a hard time punching it in with the amount of time left.
All right.
They got to make this extra point.
Harry Aker on the field? No, they're going to go for it. This is dumb.
Oh, they're going for two.
No, this is dumb. You kick the extra point, you take the gimme points.
Well, it doesn't.
And then a chance to win.
It doesn't make it any worse. If they miss it, they would have to go for two on the next
Sackman
one.
Sackman for two?
And he's in.
Still, bad strategy.
Yeah, it certainly isn't your traditional strategy there as far as that goes. But it gets it to six. So if they pull off a miracle and put it in the end zone, touchdown ties it, the extra point wins it.
All right, 29 seconds left in this one. The Silver Eagles up 27-21. All that we've got left is an onside kick, and then the result will certainly make things interesting or end the game.
There's an old baseball adage that says that you play to tie at home and you play to win on the road, and then clearly that's what Coach Minnick feels out here tonight.
I would have kicked the extra point and then gone for two if you score again.
I would have liked to have seen.
Because if you don't make it, the best you can do is tie.
I would like to have seen Monona Grove put up more of a defense on that two-point try. Sackman had no trouble.
Yeah.
Finding the seam and getting in. He barely was touched.
In.
Yeah.
All right.
All comes down to this. Monona Grove recovers. They win. If DeForest recovers, we still got a ball game.
The hands unit on the field. Nobody deeper than the 30-yard line is the onside kick ready to come. Harry Aker. No, we're going to timeout call by the Silver Eagles. Remember, 29 seconds left is all, so should the Silver Eagles recover this, all they've got to do is kneel down once.
So if you're listening to this game, you know, hang in there. There's only 29 seconds left. Once you get through the timeout, this game is about to be decided.
I know it's painful listening to us, even worse if you're on TV watching us.
Yeah, just hang in there just a little bit longer.
My poor mother, I hope she doesn't know how to use YouTube.
Another minute and a half.
She's on YouTube. She's watching kitten videos.
Well, wasn't she there for National Dog Day?
Could have been.
They say on Twitter there was a National Dog Day. There was like some 8 hillion jillion posts.
Jillion?
Of,
is that a real number?
Of pictures of dogs.
Hillion jillion.
When did National Dog Day begin? Was this the first one?
It's a Hallmark
National
Day, Bob.
Dog
Buy your dog a card.
Get your cards. Yep, your dog will appreciate a Hallmark card at $3.99. Or one that speaks.
Arf.
She cares.
All right. Harry Haker will tee it up. 29 seconds. It all comes down to this. It doesn't really, because even if DeForest recovers, they've got to still do something they haven't done all game.
Let's just have Monona Grove recover. And call
yeah,
this
let's
good.
Make it all a
let's
moot
just
point.
Call it good. Let's call this a game. Come on, MG. Fall on the ball.
All right. Aker teeing it up.
Well, it's not Aker, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, is he
five? Five is Harry Haker.
Okay. All right.
You don't know your acres, do you?
I don't. No, didn't.
There's the kick. Dahlhauser with the recovery.
Yeah, that's it.
And okay. That'll do it. Yep. The Silver Eagles will kneel down and go to 2-0 on the young season, yep. Having defeated the DeForest Norskies 27-21. Yep. Couple of exciting wins for the Silver Eagles. Dahlhauser pretty fired up there.
Oh, that's for sure. So Monona Grove led, you know, Torin Young led the way for Monona Grove tonight. I got him for 28 carries, 208 yards.
Two touchdowns.
Scored two touchdowns. A big 35-yard touchdown pass by Mitch Kelsey to Andrew Naherniak. And then, of course, Mitch Kelsey's opening play of the game, 72-yard touchdown run. It was enough to offset another great performance by DeForest running back Jaden Sackman, who's gone for 28 carries and 237 yards tonight, three touchdowns.
So junior quarterback Mitch Kelsey will kneel down, and that will do it. Kelsey getting to do the victory formation 2 weeks in a row. Silver Eagles and rookie coach Brandon Beckwith going to 2-0 on the season. Clearly the favorites to win the Badger South Conference as they start the season well on their way towards the playoffs. Well, this has been Steve Martinelli and Bob Schmuck kicking off our 20th year doing Silver Eagle football. Our first game ever on the radio for WMVO-LP Monona. This is Silver Eagle football. Thank you ever so much for watching. This has been fun, hasn't it, folks? Good night.